Well, it's as official as we can get.
Gee, this is... I'm gonna point out.
I'm sure a long fellow square when I was coming to the meeting, except like picture. Yeah, that one's pretty.
Good evening, we'll call the January 17th, 2017, meeting of the Planning Board of the Town of Cape Elizabeth to order. Before we start on this, the agenda for this evening's meetings, I would just like to say two things. One, this is sort of a chance to bid farewell to one of our members who served three terms with great distinction, Elaine Fallander. She was a great source of policy judgment, drafting skills, interpretive skills. And so I think on behalf of the board and the staff, we would like to say thank you to Elaine and wish her well. The second mention is a new member of the board, Jim Huebner, down here to my right. He has served on the board before. I guess he had so much fun, he decided he'd come back. Jim is an engineer by training, which is a skill that we can definitely use on the board, and we welcome Jim aboard and look forward to working with him. Okay, we'll get into the agenda of the meeting now. We have six items: approval of the minutes, election of officers, the Maxwell Woods subdivision, the Fusco resource protection permit, an accessory structures amendment issue, which we've been considering, and lastly, an opportunity for public comment on anything that hasn't been covered in the agenda. The items, the specific items, will also have a opportunity for public comment as they come up. The minutes of the last meeting have been circulated. Do any members have any comments? I have one minor technical correction I'd like to make, and that is the resolution on completion for the Portland Water District. At the end of the text and before the two numbered waivers, the expression "and the following waivers are granted" should be added.
What page are you on?
Oh, I'm sorry, the second page of the minutes. It's the motion regarding the completeness for Portland Water District. And that added language will simply tie the two waivers to the main text. And that's exactly how the text later on on another matter has been expressed. Anybody have any problems with that? Okay, with that change, I'll ask for a motion to approve the minutes.
Motion.
John?
Second.
Joe seconded. Any discussion on the approved motion?
I'm going to abstain just because I wasn't on the board at that time.
Fair enough.
I'm also going to abstain because I wasn't here.
Okay. We still have enough. All in favor? Opposed? The motion carries 5 in favor, 2 abstentions. The next item on the agenda, election of officers, as most of you may know, the chair and vice chair positions are 1-year posts with two gigs, if you will, if the people want it. So my gig as chair has come up, and we have discussed a successor at the workshop, and I would ask for a motion. Victoria?
I'd like to make a motion to nominate Carol Ann Jordan as our next chair.
We have a second?
Second.
Jonathan, thank you. I'll add a comment. I think Carol Ann is a wonderful choice. She's served the town for many years in many capacities and is known to run a nice, fair, and efficient meeting. I look forward to her efforts. Any further comments on Carol Ann's proposal? I'll call for a motion. All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you. We will now do a quick musical chairs, and Carol Ann will take over.
Thank you.
Thanks, Peter. I hope I can live up to your billing. And thank you for your 2 years of service as chair. All right, next order of business is to elect a vice chair, which is what I formerly was. So do you have anyone in nomination for vice chair? Peter?
I'd like to nominate Joe Chalet as vice chair.
Second.
Nominate Joe Chalet as vice chair.
I have a motion for Joe and second.
Second, yeah.
All right, all those in favor? Opposed? Joe, you're not voting?
Oh.
You can vote, Peter.
Abstaining? All right, Joe is now vice chair.
No.
All right. So to get on with our first order of business, which is the Maxwell's Woods subdivision. Joel Fitzpatrick, doing business as Maxwell Woods LLC, is requesting a major subdivision review and resource protection permit for Maxwell Woods, a 38-unit condominium and 8-apartment unit development located at 112 and 114 Spruink Avenue, Section 16-2-4, Major Subdivision Review Completeness, and Section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Permit Completeness. We are here tonight to determine whether we have a package that is fully submitted and has all the information we need in order to evaluate this project. So what we'll be doing is we'll start with a presentation by the applicant about the project. Then we will have public comment regarding completeness. And I keep emphasizing the word completeness because it isn't about the project itself. It's about whether we have the materials in hand before we get to a substantive review of the project. And the board will then consider the finding of completeness, whether it is complete or not. And if the application is deemed incomplete, board members will identify them. So we will go on with that. And after that, we will decide on whether we want a site walk. And then the board will begin substantive discussion of the application at the close. And then we will set it's deemed complete. And once all other discussion is complete, we will set a public hearing for this project. So we'll start with the presentation. Please state your name, rank, and serial number.
Certainly. Good evening, Madam Chairman, members of the board. My name is Owens McCullough. I'm a civil engineer with the firm of Sebago Technics, representing Wiley Enterprises on this project. With me tonight is Joel Fitzpatrick, who many of you probably know from his prior projects in town. Joel is currently constructing the Cottage Brook condominium portion of Spruink Woods, which is next door. And I have a pointer here. So Cottage Brook condominium is up here. That is part of the Spruink Woods project. Joel came in front of the board for a minor amendment to that a little over a year ago. Joel has constructed the infrastructure into the units and is working on four of the buildings currently. Water, sewer, road, access, all of that is into the site. It'll really start to take shape more this coming construction season. During the course of all of this, Joel entered into a dialogue with the Maxwells and the farm here. And during the course of that conversation, they came to an agreement on a purchase and sale agreement so that Joel could look to construct a multiplex project meeting the town's open space or open space zoning. This is the RC zone. He's proposing to develop in accordance with the open space zone. The project would entail 36 duplex condominiums and two buildings that are four-unit multiplexes for rentals, essentially apartments in this location, and then these would be the condominium portion of the project. Again, it's 36 units for the condominium and 8 units for the multiplex portion for a total of 46 units Ironically, it's the same density that Eastman Meadows is that he developed a few years ago. It's nearly complete. We did make a submittal to the town for completeness review. That is in front of you, which is what we're here for tonight. And I'll just spend a few minutes to give you an overview of some of the projects, the permitting things that we're working on with the project. We are proposing to extend Astor Lane through to Spurwink Road here, making this connection through here. That connection certainly we think will help improve the connection to the Spurwink Woods project, which when you go into that development really only has one way in. This will provide a second means of access. That will also become a public road. 22 feet with esplanade and sidewalk on this side of the road through here. We're basically following the alignment of the existing farm road that comes in and goes around the Maxwell Pond. When you get up to the Maxwell Woods Drive in here where the condominium is, that is essentially a driveway, private road associated with the development and will be maintained as part of the condominium association. The unit approach here is very similar to what Joel did at Eastman Meadows, almost identical in the unit type and the intent of the development. His market sector at Eastman Meadows and here in Cottage Brook has been essentially the 55 and older group. It's a demographic that has been identified as needing housing. The nice part, there's been a lot of work, studies done around this. I think Marita did something here in the last, it's been 6 or 7 years, I guess, now, a study on it. But it's a section of the population that is reaching that age that's transitioning from single-family homes, not ready for the independent care facilities, but want their own place. And that's what this is targeted at. These units are single-story units designed around ease of access, handicap capability, two-car garages within each unit, individual driveways served by public water, sewer, underground electric, telephone cable services for each of those projects. The project is part of the open space zoning. What we're proposing to do is we're going to connect into the open space that exists as part of the Cottage Brook development here. That's actually town-owned open space. There's town-owned open space over here as part of the Spurwink Woods. This area in here is going to all become open space as part of the project. And then we're going to create open space all around the development, around the perimeter of it. This will expand the open space that's between the two developments. There'll be a trail network developed within the project connecting to the Cottage Brook and Spurwink Woods Trail. That trail will run down along here behind these units, meander in through the wooded area down through here. It'll come back up here to the intersection of the road. There's a public sidewalk on this side, and we are proposing a trail connection. I'm sorry, it's right here, through the woods over to the trail within Spurwink Woods. The open space is required to be 45%. In our submittal, we are showing about 48%. Since the submittal, we took another look at the how we calculated the open space. How we calculated the net density. It turned out this access road here, we had accidentally double deducted, so we took that away from Joel. It should have been part of the overall parcel development. We've taking a look at that. Basically, all it means is that we're still providing the same amount of open space, the density still works, and that'll all be updated in the future submittals, but we will be addressing that as part of it. This project also will require a Site Location of Development Act permit. We've actually held a public informational meeting around that this week, last week on Wednesday. Get my weeks mixed up here. And we held a pre-app meeting with the DEP today. We're looking to submit that application within the next 2 weeks. to go through that process. Basically, we're over 3 acres of non-revegetated surface, so that's required a site law project. The project will include its own separate stormwater management system that will include catch basins to collect the surface water runoff. It will all be treated to the DEP Chapter 500 standards, which means we treat 95% of the impervious or hard surfaces, and 80% or 85% of the landscaped areas that will all go into either under-drained soil filters, and then these devices called focal points. It's basically a type of under-drained soil filter with stormwater detention through underground systems. And those will be located in various points throughout the development. I think there'll be a focal point here. There'll be one over in here. There's an under-drained soil filter, I believe, in this area here, one over here. There's actually a sand filtration system back here and another under-drained soil filter in this location there. And those are all detailed in the plans and will be reviewed by both the DEP and the town's peer review engineer for the project. At the entrance of the development, where we meet out to Spurwink Woods, one of the things that we will be doing in this location is there's a ledge knoll right here that does impede the site distance on Spurwink Road, and we're going to be removing that knoll to better facilitate the site distance in this direction. Over in here, there's some vegetation that has grown right up to the edge of the road or pretty close to it, and we're going to cut that vegetation back to facilitate the site distance in both directions to meet the town code requirements. What we found with traffic generation on these sort of projects is that they're a very low traffic generator. When we did the Eastman Meadows project, that was a pretty substantive discussion over there. And when we got done with the project, and now that it's developed, the traffic generation is very light. The types of residents that we're looking in this are not, you know, your single family residents that have children that need to go back and forth to soccer or school or whatever. These are folks that are empty nesters, folks that may or may not be retired yet, but their patterns are much different, and we're seeing that as part of this project. I've worked on several others similar to this with a company called Kasperzak Land Bank in Gorham, Wells, Kennebunk, and Topson. And we find the similar patterns of traffic as part of that. I'll take a few minutes to give you, make sure I can get to the next slide here. This is a picture of a unit at Eastman Meadows, gives you an idea of what the units will look like. Single story, a porch, landscaping. This one happened to be just planted last year when they went in. This one was part of a duplex unit. It'll be very similar to what Joel is planning at the Maxwell Woods project. Another picture of what one looks like with the grass and the vegetation and landscaping installed. This is a, we didn't get a chance to do a color up, but, and it looks better on paper than it does up here on the screen, but this is a view of the apartments. Or the multiplex units, each one is 4 units, 2 on the first floor, 2 on the second floor. You'll see some stairs on the exterior here. Those are being moved to internal.
Correct, Joel.
So there won't be these stairs that protrude out. They'll be internal to the building. So that is one change. It'll be of similar construction material types. There'll be variations in roof pitches as part of the units. I wanted to show this graphic, which is an overall area plan. So what you see in kind of the magenta here is the proposed open space that is part of Maxwell Woods. The green open space you see is part of Spurwink Woods. And then it shows some other town-owned open space that links between various areas. I know Maureen has been, there's been some dialogue with Canterbury Development for some trail connections through this development. So this provides a chance to, or an opportunity to consolidate some more open space within this area. And again, we're looking to put 45%, which is required under the open space zoning, into open space. The open space, and I don't know if Joel, we're contemplating, we'll spend some more time talking about this, but there's some discussion, at least with Joel, that maybe we would want to make this open space under town ownership since it's next to the town. So that seemed to make some logic in that. Joel and I and Maureen will have more discussion on that. Sorry, Maureen, we just sort of, Joel, what's that?
Ian Ford.
Yeah. And so this one in through here, open space would be owned by the association with a public easement for the trails. So the trails are open to the public, but the open space itself would be owned and managed by the association. There is a chunk of land here that if you look on the subdivision plan, it's called a conservation, an agricultural conservation land that is going to be put into open space. It'll be restricted to be in perpetuity, not developed, but it will allow the Maxwells to continue doing some farming, agricultural farming in this area, but it will be pulled out of any future development potential and be put into an open space component. With our submittal, we've provided, we went through each of the requirements for the completeness review. The town peer review engineer has looked over the plans, had some technical comments. Maureen has gone through her list. It appears that we're not missing any information on the project, but obviously we have more meetings and more technical information and more substantive discussion to go on the project. I think tonight we would be hopeful to introduce the project like I've done here with the board, to go through the completeness review, maybe set up a site walk if that's appropriate, and to look forward to the next meetings for further discussion. And with that, I'll turn it back to the board. Thank you.
Thank you. Right. That being done, we will open the meeting for public comment regarding completeness. If anybody has any comments about whether the submission has been, he's followed all the submission requirements. Right. Yes, sorry.
Thank you.
And we ask during these public comment periods that you keep your comments to 3 minutes. But to allow as many people to speak who want to speak, and in the interest of time, we keep it brief. And you're addressing the board, and we will keep track of any questions to be answered by the applicant.
Greetings, my name is Paul Seidman, 21 Oakview Drive. I have a process question. Are there opportunities for general comment at the end of the meeting?
Yes. Not on this project, but on other things that are not on the agenda. Are there many people who wish to speak? Okay, line her up. Let's go. If you want to speak, could you please rise, stand in a line so we can address them as quickly as possible? I appreciate it.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Becky Fernald. I live on Mitchell Road. And I just had a question about the designation of the open space, because my understanding it's 45% is designated for open space. And I'm not exactly clear where that is on this particular map. And I heard some reference to agricultural land. Is that included in the 45%?
Okay. We'll get your question answered.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Yeah.
And if I may add also, this particular tract of land has really unique and old pine forests that probably have been there for over 100 years, and has a very beautiful trail system already. And I'm wondering, I would like to know if that is part of the open space. It would, with the emphasis on the town trail system and connectivity to Greenbelt Trail, it would seem to make perfect sense to maintain that trail as to be connected to the Greenbelt Trail. So I'd like to know whether that is part of the open space. And I also would like to know about, as far as, I'm not sure if this is part of the completeness packet, but if this is in compliance with the comprehensive plan of the town. I know the comprehensive plan is now being, there's a committee to work on a new comprehensive plan, and I think that, you know, is this in keeping with the number of condos that are being built in Cape Elizabeth, and if this very large condo project, if the size and scale of it is in compliance with the comprehensive plan.
All right. Thank you. We'll get answers.
Michael Layton, 17 Canterbury Way. I'd like to begin with a quote from the comprehensive plan. When Cape Elizabeth and what is now South Portland mutually agreed to split at the turn of the 20th century, a key factor in the decision was Cape Elizabeth's desire to issue the modern trappings of commercial development, expensive utilities and infrastructure in favor of traditional farming and fishing identity. 100 years later, Cape Elizabeth has embraced modern living and taken its place as a desirable suburb of the city of Portland, but still clings to its farming roots. While the acreage devoted to and jobs derived from farming decline, the town has also taken steps to preserve remaining farmland and elements of the rural character prized by most residents. My wife and I have lived in Cape for over 20 years. Yes, we are from away, but chose to live here. I was transferred here by the Coast Guard from California and stayed upon my retirement. My wife relocated from Pennsylvania. We had many options of where in the country and what part of southern Maine to live. We chose Cape Elizabeth because of the previous quote. We chose our current home a year ago because it abutted farmland, as illustrated on an agricultural resource map in the comprehensive plan, and a desire to get away from the town center. Another concept I feel conflicts with the elements of the comprehensive plan, but I'll leave that discussion for another day. Our concerns with this development are many and varied. They include the calculations used to determine open space. Do the wetland and agricultural designations count as open space? Is a 15-foot wide swath of land really open space? Is farmland with buildings open space? Is the pond open space? These allocations may meet the letter of the law, but they satisfy the spirit of the law. The elimination of yet another wildlife habitat, the corridor for wildlife migration, and the destruction of the old growth pine trees. We've observed a great horned owl, pileated woodpeckers, fox, deer in these woods. Destroying the rest of Spurwink Woods will destroy their home. The timing of this development and the current review of the comprehensive plan. We'd like to see the proposed development delayed until the comprehensive plan is updated. If the development does go forward, we'd like to see buffers, meaning the preservation of current trees, as large as possible. For example, behind our home, one of the closest points to the development, the tree line cut kind of bulges towards us. Move that cut line away from our property line and closer to the development, making the buffer wider. We don't want new plantings to count, as we won't be around when they begin buffering. We worry about the actual buffer and its reduction as blowdown occurs as a result of the clear cutting, as well as the buffer between the proposed development and the Cottage Brook development. We're concerned with the setback in the southwest corner adjacent to the wetland and the proximity of the proposed trail to this wetland. Finally, we're troubled with the length of the project. Will we be dealing with years and years of construction? We have a chance to be leaders in the area and not end up like our neighbors in Scarborough and South Portland, who by no stretch of the imagination can be considered rural these days. After all, isn't that why we became Cape Elizabeth? I'd like to conclude with one more quote from the vision statement in the comprehensive plan, which states, continue the current slow pace and pattern of development. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Carrie Gilbert. I live at 32 Astor Lane, just up the road from this project. There's a couple things I hope you would all look at when you're reviewing the completeness of the application. The first is the demand for condos of this type. There are 20 going in right next door, or 19, and there's quite a few in Eastman Meadows that are all exactly the same. And I worry that at some point there may just be too many. The timeline of the project is another concern. I think the project next door has 10 years to build all of the condos. Right now it's basically a open wasteland, and I'm concerned if they clear cut this whole area, we're going to be looking at that for another similar period of time. Also, the protections to the land during the construction process. This past summer, we had sand blowing all over, everywhere. There's a huge sand pile, huge pile of dirt. I'm not sure how safe it is there's lots of kids living in the neighborhood. And the last thing to look at would be the definition of open space and the selection of open space. I'm not sure, this agricultural land is not necessarily the most pristine looking agricultural land, which I'm sure you'll see on your site visit. It's storing, I believe, some trailers right now. Also, one of the most beautiful parts of the land is, as several others have mentioned, is a beautiful forest kind of on this end, and that is not appear to be preserved. That's what I'd look for when you're reviewing the application.
Hi, my name is Adam Day. I live at 11 Hamlin Street, just up the road from this development. I'd echo a lot of the previous concerns. This is a pretty pristine looking piece of land. So I would definitely urge you to think about the environmental impacts and just the, you know, the these are old trees. Once they're cut down, they can't be replanted. I'm also kind of curious about some of the selection of open space here. It seemed like in some of the early proposals for this plan, it also included the lake and surrounding building areas. So I'm not quite sure how this view that we're looking at here really meets that 45 percent. It seems like it must include some of the space in between the condos. So I think that's, you know, something interesting to look at. I'd also echo Carrie's concerns with timeline. We're currently looking at 10 years of construction with the Cottage Brook condos. That could easily stretch out with this. Housing is booming right now, but we could easily enter another recession period. And I'd hate to see a spot like this clear cut and then not be able to be completed and sold as planned. So timeline's definitely a concern. We also have dealt with some of the sand blowing issues from the Cottage Brook site. This summer I routinely vacuumed out our windowsills with sand, so it's just something to consider, impacts in the neighborhood. Like others have said, we really enjoy this, currently with the Greenbelt Trails. It's a beautiful piece of property, so just some things to think about. Thank you.
Hello, John Powers. I live on 12 Astor Lane. I was actually the first house to build in Cottage Brook, and that was 5 years ago. I'm not one to move into a new development, tear down trees, and then say not in my backyard. I knew moving in that phase 1, 2, and 3 would take place, and that's part of the reason I chose to move in, to be into a larger neighborhood, a network of families. Currently we have an estimated probably 60 kids that live in Cottage Brook, and there's one road going into Cottage Brook right now. It's one road going in, winding, and I don't think it's necessarily safe with the 60 kids. They end up in the streets a lot versus the sidewalks. with the extension of Astor Lane, they could have a new way to get in and out of Cottage Brook. The 60 kids that I mentioned are before phase three condos, which will add, I believe, 19 new units, which is an estimated 38 new cars coming through a one-way Astor Lane. You add this development, we now have those 38 new cars that are probably going to be without kids because they're empty nesters, as mentioned, accessing their condos. So without the development, we have 38 new cars coming in, passing through where 60 kids live. So I like the proposal of the extension of Astor Lane. I would ask the developer to consider adding that first. So while construction is taking place, construction vehicles access the development of phase three and the new proposal. Construction vehicles go that way and not through where the residents live. We've had 5 years of building with these kids. I fully anticipated that. The end is in sight for that traffic. And with the addition of the extension of Astor Lane, the end is in sight even quicker because I think phase three should take 3 years. So without the extension of Astor Lane, we have 3 years of all this additional traffic coming in with, they come in and they come out the way where these 60 kids and, you know, probably 60 adults live. I guess that's most, there, you know, the 45, 55, you know, that has to be determined and, you know, verified if it's the right amount of land. And I think there should be checks and balances. I don't want to give an open pass to the developer, but when I chose to move to Cape Elizabeth, I looked at Yarmouth, I looked at Scarborough, I looked at Falmouth. I looked at available buildable lots. I knew moving into Cape Elizabeth that there was not that much opportunity to build. And so, but I knew of this. I knew what was available by private ownership. My understanding is that Maxwell's want to sell this property. So I guess my two questions are, can Astor Lane extension be built first to have construction vehicles go that way to construct phase three and the new Maxwell Woods? And if the Maxwells own the property, are they in any way being coerced to sell this property? Outside of that, it's their property to sell. Thank you.
Thank you. Let him go.
Hi, good evening. My name's Joe Baum, and I live at 85 Spurwink Ave. So I'm that little white driveway there that's connected to Astor Lane. I wasn't planning to speak this evening, but because the gentleman was expressing his interest in adding Astor Lane, I would actually ask that it wasn't added. That's actually my driveway. I moved there 6 days ago. I didn't know that this existed. I have a big, beautiful bay window. That's going to be headlights. That's going to be 60 cars of headlights, and then however many vehicles are moving into this apartment complex, which I would imagine is another 30. When I was 1 year old, I lived in Cape Elizabeth as well, off of Pleasant Avenue, in my grandparents' house, the Civilis. And I wanted to move back with my wife. And so literally the most affordable place that I could find was a two-bedroom ranch on Spurwink Avenue. So just finding about this 2 days ago by some neighbors that we were walking the dog in this beautiful area, I would just ask that they move the Astor Lane extension maybe around the pond the other direction. I don't know if that's possible. I did see that there is an access road there, but I did not realize that the road would be facing directly into my house. It would be a lot of traffic extending both into the new Maxwell Woods area, but as well as the other condominium area as well. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Carissa Hanratty. I live with my husband and three young children at 111 Spurwink Avenue, directly across from the Maxwell's Farm. I would echo the gentleman who just spoke in that I would much prefer not to have construction vehicles, huge trucks going through right passing right through my house day and night, as they were actually this summer while I was home on maternity leave with my six-month-old. I would also request something past anecdotal observation. Is there any empirically based evidence with regard to the comment with regard to traffic? It was in part based upon a 55-plus, I guess, demographic who is going in there. Is this set in stone, or is it a requirement to buy these properties to be 55-plus? Otherwise, that comment really holds no water. My husband and I, obviously, one of the biggest issues for us would be the traffic impact. Our house is maybe 10 feet from the edge of Spurwink Avenue. Like I said, we have three very young children. People drive exceptionally fast down Spurwink as it is, way too fast. I feel at this point that should the amount of traffic increase, I mean, we would have to put up a fence in our front yard. I'm already considering privacy, some sort of privacy fencing or bushing, because the traffic, the headlights, we also have a bay window. We have a bay window on our front, or on the first floor and the second floor, one above each other. That second bay window goes directly into my children's bedroom. We are flooded by traffic lights as it is currently. So some more investigation into the actual impact of the additional traffic would be much appreciated. Thank you.
How many more people desire to speak? I just want a head count here. I'm just looking. Okay.
Hi, Andrew Gilbert, 32 Astor Lane. I'm going to actually try and speak to the completeness part of this, but to be honest, I'm not actually even sure what a complete package would be. So I'm just going to say a few things that, so there's a few things that have been brought up to me that I just wanted to point out. One is that I know Trout Brook watershed has actually been an important issue for certainly the town of South Portland, also Cape Elizabeth. And I know it's probably part of the DEP package. I don't know, but I actually printed out this map. It's actually the Trout Brook watershed, which actually shows the development as part of it. So I'd hope that that actually was addressed in the planning process here. I don't know in the papers that they're submitted if anything referencing that has been addressed. So I would hope it would be. Secondly, and actually looking at I was here last week, they submitted a site plan, and looking at both the town management or the plan for the town and looking at the plan that was submitted, there's a discrepancy in the RP1. There's like an RP1 wetland zone that actually is not the same on both of those. So I don't have any idea why they're different. I mean, in one, the pond is actually encircled as a RP1 zone. And in the town plan, it's actually a whole separate area south of the pond. So I would think that would need to be addressed. I certainly wouldn't accept a plan that doesn't have the correct day layers. And then finally, part of the town plan, I know, is the importance of wildlife habitat. I'm actually a wildlife biologist. And also addressing connectivity between the town properties or the open space properties. If I'm looking at this from a wildlife perspective, the Spurwink, what's really not shown is the Canterbury Woods property that is actually a large sort of valuable piece of wildlife habitat right now. And it's connected directly to where basically all those condos are going in. And then through that to actually the town-owned piece of wetland. If I was an animal trying to get to it and I had all these condos in the way, that's certainly not gonna work. And they're less likely to come around to this tiny little strip of buffer here on the south side next to Spurwink. So I would certainly ask that the sort of thoughtfulness of where the open space is being placed in relationship to the other open spaces for the town be considered. Because right now I don't think it actually has been. And it's explicitly stated in the town plan that wildlife corridors and connectivity between the open spaces is a consideration. So I would certainly ask that that is considered. Thanks.
Thank you. Anyone else? We good? All right. I will close the public hearing portion of this meeting and move to the board to discuss completeness. Any questions? Victoria?
I do have one question in regards to completeness. When I was going through the elevations and floor plans, I could not find any information in regards to the single-story, single units, and there'll be four of them. And I, when it comes to completeness, I hesitate to say we have everything we need in front of us when we don't have any idea what that'll look like. I don't want to stop tonight's meeting and take a vote saying this is not complete because we're missing what are these buildings going to look like. I would have to say then to people presenting this is that I want those plans, and I'm sure you're going to give us them, but I want those, and I will vote that down if we do not see elevations and floor plans for the single units. That's my comment.
Any other questions? Comments? Go ahead.
Just with one question for the applicant with regards to the tab 20, which is the trip generation assessment, which I think is another term for a traffic study. From my view of the traffic study, it really only pertains to the 38 condos and two multiplex apartment buildings going in. However, what you've told us is that Astor Lane is actually going to connect the other neighborhood. So I think that we would need to see a traffic study that would also consist of, at a maximum, given the fact that there could be generation from the other project, of what that would look like for a traffic study on this exit onto Spurwink Avenue. I think that would be important to see because I don't think we would get a full traffic analysis. I understand we would for just the Maxwell Woods project, but however, there is talk that that's going to connect the other condos from the other neighborhood as well as all the single family dwellings on that. So I would echo Victoria's statement with regards to that, that I would like to see a more thorough assessment of the traffic, given the fact that part of this project is going to connect the Cottage Brook neighborhood to this road. So I think for my sake, I would like to see that information.
All right. Mr. McCullough, would you like to get up and answer some of these questions that we've had? Take them in any order you want.
Okay. I'll go back three pages. Maybe I can just start with the open space. The open space in the plan submittal we provided on the subdivision plan, of course, this is a rendering to put up here on the board, but we've got 30 plan sheets in there that actually detail out where the open space is, what those areas are. The open space over here follows along the property line and around these multiplex units. So this would all become open space in through here, this entire area. That area of open space, I can tell you approximately how many acres it is. The total is about 8.45 acres of open space through the entire project. The open space on this side, so there's open space, this line right there is what was approved as part of the Cottage Brook, and that's the common property line right there. So there's a section of open space that comes right along here and a trail that runs through it. What we're proposing to do is add another strip of open space on the back side of these condos so that we create a larger continuous open space area that connects between Astor Lane and the trail system on the back. Knowing that Canterbury is over here on this side, we are also proposing to create a strip of open space along the back side of these units that includes a trail system all the way down. And on the subdivision plans, there are meets and bounds that show exactly the dimensions and areas for each of the open spaces. Coming down in through here, the open space wraps around. This line comes through here, back around up to here. There's a line through here. This is open space all through here with the meandering trail through there. This wall will be retained as wooded areas. Now, those wooded areas range in size from buffer areas at the property line between 75 and a couple hundred feet, depending on where you're at along the property line. This is the open space where the conservation easement would go, and that would become dedicated open space, basically taking away any potential development, further development of the property. It would be retained for agricultural use, farming, and I think I heard somebody make a comment before about preserving farming in the community, and this provides that opportunity in this area right here. The pond and this area right here of the Maxwell Farm is not part of the project. That is being retained as part of the Maxwell Farm. This pond here will remain. When we build the road, we are replacing the outlet culvert here that outlets the pond, but that culvert needs to be replaced. It was in pretty tough shape, so we are going to be replacing that culvert. The pond here is an RP1, and the town has maps which were created from, and Maureen probably can speak to this better than I can, but they're created at a much larger scale to generally show where those RP1 areas are. The applicant had retained Longview consultants who are wetland scientists, soil scientists, that went out and mapped all the wetlands on the property, looked at all of the types of wetlands to definitively identify, as required in the town code, which ones are RP1s, which ones are RP2 wetlands. The wetlands on this project, an interesting aspect of this project is we're not actually disturbing any wetlands. There's one sliver of wetland in the back that will remain undisturbed. It's a small area in the back. There's no wetland in this area. There is some wetland down here associated with the pond at the lower portion of it. It's an RP2. This wetland, the pond is an RP1, and there is a 250-foot setback around that pond. And is it 100? I'm sorry, it's 100 because of the size of it. Thank you, Maureen. And we do show that 100-foot on our plans, and no buildings or site construction will occur within that other than the reconstruction of this access road coming up through the site. So we have gone on-site, done specific on-site investigations around the wetlands, vernal pools, identifying what's RP1 and what's RP2. So that's similar to any other project that would be done in the Cape to definitively identify that. Let me see if I can keep going here a little bit. The project as being part of the Site Location of Development Act permit, we've notified IF&W, Inland Fisheries and Wildlife, and actually got response back from them that they've identified no critical habitat or species within this area. There's a letter that we received from them, and I would have to remember, I think it's actually in the submittal package.
It is.
And so we've gone through that process. That's part of the site law requirements. We've actually notified the Historic Preservation Office also as part of it. They've gone through it. We've filed to the Natural Heritage Program to review it. We haven't gotten their response, but that's not uncommon. They look for rare or endangered plants. We didn't see anything on the database. The only thing that we have to contend with, which any site in Maine, no matter where it is, has to contend with, is bats, the northern long-eared bat. There are clearing restrictions you'll see in any wildlife letter that's now issued is there's specific times of the years when they want you to do clearing. I think it's in like July through November or something. So there's some specific clearing around that, and that's actually noted in the wildlife habitat. The project is situated within the Trout Brook watershed that is listed in our stormwater management plan. It is also listed in our DEP Site Location and Development Act permit. As part of the Trout Brook watershed, we are meeting the Chapter 500 requirements because it is a non-attainment stream, and the town has a watershed plan that includes a compensation fee utilization plan. The applicant will be paying into that plan, and our calculations right now are around $25,000 that would go into that plan. And that money would be paid prior to them getting their, prior to the applicant getting the DEP permit. And the intent of that plan is there are prioritized improvements within the watershed that that money goes to. I couldn't tell you exactly what, I don't remember off the top of my head, but the plan is written, and maybe Maureen could give us some guidelines on that. As far as the project being consistent with the comprehensive plan, we would submit that it is. If you look into the housing guidelines in the comprehensive plan, one of the goals is diversification of housing, addressing the senior housing. This project is intended to address that specific need. The access road, Astor Lane, the gentleman that spoke earlier about wondering if that would be built first so that construction traffic could come in that way and not through Spurwink Woods. We've actually already discussed that, and in fact we would be proposing to build that first so that the construction access comes into the development. And one thing we're doing on the project to try and help mitigate the construction time period is all the roadway utility infrastructure would be built at one time, not phased. It would be come in and be built and done, and then it would just be the individual units that would be built over time as they're sold. So unlike some projects where you'll see a section of road built and then they'll develop it and then they'll come back and build another road, we are proposing to do the whole thing at one time. I need to look at my notes because timeline for project that kind of addresses that we are, if the approvals come through, more than likely it could be that the project would start in mid to late summer. If the timings works, the applicant would try to have base paving down on the road infrastructure during the 2017 construction season. If there isn't enough time because of the timeline for approvals, then it would be completed in the spring and summer of 2018 for the infrastructure. The build out of the units, I'd have to leave Joel to speak to that. He would love to be able to build them all and be done in a year, but I don't think that'll happen. But Eastman Meadows, 6 years for Eastman Meadows, which was 46 units. We would expect something comparable to this, but the road and infrastructure would be done initially. Trying to see if I've missed what I've missed in here. I've touched on a lot of it. The traffic study. So when we went through Eastman Meadows, we sort of went through the same sort of discussion. And actually at Eastman Meadows, one of the things was depending on the, there was concern that if the demographics were such that it wasn't what we expected and there were families and other folks coming into it, that there was a mechanism, I think, in that approval that we would recount, reassess the traffic, and decide if there was any additional work needed. That never happened because the demographics that were all what we expected, the empty nesters, 55 and older, we were trying not to restrict it specifically to that. There could be... you know, on some of the other 55 and olders I've seen, there could be periods of time where maybe a child or a family member comes and stays with them for a period of time. So we didn't want to restrict it around that, but it is designed around attracting that demographic. There aren't playgrounds inside. It's not set up well for families coming into it. There's limited common elements around the condominiums. It's really specifically designed to try to attract a specific demographic, which has proved true with Eastman Meadows, and we're going to see the same thing with the Cottage Brook condominium. Also around traffic, we will, one of the discussions actually in the peer reviewer, so the completeness review is we submitted a traffic study, we fully expected it would be reviewed and commented on, and as part of the carry-on conversations and discussions, there would be more discussion around the traffic study. The peer reviewer had made a comment about, I think it's in Maureen's notes, about some traffic counts up at Spurwink and Route 77 and some additional review of the traffic. We are certainly planning and have discussed doing that additional work as we've had this initial submittal, began the dialogue, some follow-on work is expected and will be done as part of the project. I have to admit I'm a little confused on the elevations in the plan submittal. We had submitted, and maybe I just misunderstood, but there are elevations of the condominiums. There's a floor plan for the apartment, both first and second floor, and elevations of the apartment complex. And we did include a floor plan for the condominiums that would be in the project. So if there's something else we could provide.
The one that I mentioned, please provide that.
I just want to make sure I know which one it is. So.
Okay. I wasn't able to find, but please point it out. I believe you're building four single units, not duplex.
Yes.
I could not find any renderings, elevations, floor plans regarding those units. But if they're in there, if you could just tell me what sheet number.
Oh, so what those are is literally the same. So you have a duplex. You just don't construct the duplex. The singleplex will look identical as just one unit in itself. We can simply cut the page and show the single unit.
Yeah,
so the single unit is basically half of the duplex unit. It's identical. So the duplex units, you have basically two identical units that meet in the middle in the garage. The singleplex is just one of those units that looks exactly like half of the duplex.
It makes sense, and I'd like to see them in the plans.
Sure, we can.
So that when I say I like how that looked, it's more than you just telling me it's.
Yep.
This meeting it's happening.
We can break that off for you.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Certainly. As far as open space and zoning, we spent considerable time before we got to this point meeting with town staff. We actually went to the Conservation Commission back in the summer and presented the project. We believe we have met the requirements around the open space, and I would ask if staff has anything else to add to that. I mean, we can continue that discussion, but we've worked hard around that whole concept though since the summer to come up with a plan that is consistent with the requirements of the ordinance, meeting that 45% open space, providing trail connectivity within the development. We've tried to show the trails that we're aware of in the area. We know that Canterbury, there's been some continuing dialogue between the town and Canterbury, and we see this as just an add-on to that trail system and formalizing it on this property. If there are any trails on the property right now, they're informal and they're not dedicated trails. This provides an opportunity as part of this development to dedicate those trails, providing specific public easements over those trails and dedicating the open space. But if I've missed anything, please let me know.
I know we'll be discussing many of these points in more detail when we get further into the project.
Sure.
Henry, you have a question?
Yeah, I have one question. I noticed that on your assumptions over the traffic impact, you'd made a best case scenario in terms of, oh, it's going to be the same as the other development and we're not going to have under 55s there, but it's not mandatory to go under it. So, thank you. I thought my voice carried quite well without it, but obviously it doesn't.
I had the duty tonight.
Thank you. So, I guess I'd like to see a worst case scenario, or possibly not worst case, but a medium case scenario, where, you know, as house prices go up, people can't afford so much, so maybe a younger couples occupy it, and it becomes more of a general style. But that's not taken care of, because the assessment on the traffic flow is that it's an older group. So I find that a little bit, that it's not quite complete as far as I'm concerned. What would happen if a younger group had it? So I would like to see the figures relating to 35s, younger married couples.
So as we go on, what we could do is, I'd call it a sensitivity analysis, where we will look at a comparison of if it is all 55 and if there's a mix, maybe a third would be non-55 and older, or maybe a third would not be empty nesters, maybe a half. We went through this exact same scenario in Eastman Meadows, and again, what we decided there was, is after the development was 50% build out or 60% build out, we would look at the demographics in there. If those demographics had changed, then we were going to do some additional assessment as part of the Eastman Meadows project, and that was a condition of the approval to try to get at, I guess, what you're suggesting. In that case, when we went back and looked at it, it never came to fruition. It was all of the empty nesters group. So we're certainly willing to look at that, and maybe we could evaluate and do a little comparison if it's, you know, well, half, or we're open to some discussion around dialogue around that.
The reason I ask is because I'm quite familiar with the other, but there's another development which is a more mature one, which is next to the golf course on that same road. Mm. And I happen quite frequently, in fact tomorrow as well, to go in and out with some friends of mine who live there. And I noticed that coming in and out of that can be a bit difficult because you can't always see exactly what's coming down. 77's a main road, cars are going not necessarily at the speed limit, possibly in excess. And so a little bit more traffic and you have a little bit of problems on 77. Now, I'm not saying that it's definitely the case, but I would like to see some experts or at least some figures to tell us what that impact would be. I don't know if my fellow board members feel the same way, but that's my
question. Well, we've stepped forward on this item, and Maureen even mentioned it in her memo. We are going to see if either A, DOT has some recent counts up at 77 and Spurwink Road. If they don't, then we'll probably do our own counts, look at the traffic generation from our project, and see how that would influence that intersection. And we can look at it in a couple of scenarios with all 55 and older in through here, or maybe a split or a mix. And depending on which direction we go, we could always even put a condition in the project similar to Eastman Meadows that after a certain percentage of development, we will reassess whether we're getting the demographics we expected. I think on Eastman Road, there was some discussion around traffic calming that would be completed. And I think Joel even posted some money for that.
Well,
was that?
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Just one.
Okay, can I? We're really getting down into the weeds here.
All right.
Okay, I'll back off.
And we've had at least two people bring up a need for a more robust traffic study. and you've got that piece of information, and you're going to move ahead with a more robust traffic study. Jim, you have a...
Yeah. Tab 11, I don't know if you have the tab 11, first page. I'm assuming that's an error. Connect to the existing main on Eastman Road. I'm assuming that's Spurwink Ave.
Yeah, that should be
Spurwink Avenue. That's a heck of a long pipe.
The good news is the water district got it right.
Yeah. Tab 14, I know you requested the response from the historic preservation. Have you gotten a response?
Did that come in yet? Yes, we have, but it came in after the town's submittal.
Okay.
And I believe that came back clean. There was no concerns.
No concerns? Right? Okay. Tab 16, did you get a response from Maine Natural Areas Program?
We have not yet.
Okay.
And that was filed a month ago or more.
Okay. Which are the affordable, 10% of the affordable units, which ones are they?
Well, I don't know that Joel has decided which ones would be affordable. If you have an idea, Joel, maybe you should come up and point out, but at this point, you would have to assign some of those units to affordable. I don't know that we actually picked specific ones, but we just have to make sure that 10% would be affordable.
Will you just charge less, or will you construct them differently or omit
something? No, they're built the same.
Okay. Let's see. Have you done any electrical design yet?
The plans, so the plans we'll send to CMP once we got the road and infrastructure alignment worked out, and let them do the layout for the electrical. Anytime I lay out electrical, they change it on me, so it'll all be underground electric.
It'll be underground electrical?
Yeah.
So you'll have some transformers sitting around?
Yeah.
Okay. You've got, across from the apartments, the two apartment buildings, you've got 2 6-inch sewers and 2 1-inch water lines stubbed out and ended on the south side of Astor Road. What are those for?
As part of the purchase and sale agreement, the Bamfords requested that we stub those out for them.
Okay.
I heard that they're either going to build a house or maybe they'll break off a family lot up in there, but that was a specific request as part of the purchase and sale.
All right. Are the units going to be sprinkled?
Jim?
Oh. Can Maureen jump in?
I just want to contribute that anytime there's the potential for digging up the road, the Public Works Director likes stubs.
Yeah.
So
oh no.
We would also support that.
I just saw them, and I figured I'd ask the question of what they were for. Are the units going to be sprinkled at all?
I don't believe so, Joel. No.
Okay. Let's see. I guess when you do the electrical design, we'll know what the street where the street lights are going to be.
Well, that's an interesting comment, because we had this discussion with the previously that. Town, I believe them. This is a town policy. We're not proposing any street lights. I believe the town prefers not to have street lights.
Okay, I missed that. I didn't know that.
Do you?
Yeah. Go ahead.
I mean, this is a question that's asked periodically, and the reality is that every time, I shouldn't say every time, the last two times there's been a downturn and there's been a lot of pressure to cut the municipal budget, one of the things that happens is some of the existing street lights get turned off.
Okay.
So because we're turning off the ones we have, it doesn't make a lot of sense to require more to be installed. So what we encourage any applicant to do is only to propose a street light where they really think one is needed.
Okay. All right.
We are going to have pedestal lights, small incandescent pedestal lights in front of each of the condominium units.
Say that again, I'm sorry.
There'll be pedestal lights in front of the, you know, in front of each of the units, so it provides lights the walkway coming up, so it does provide some lighting around there. Okay. But that'll all be private.
All right, I think I'm all set.
Okay. I saw some hands over here.
I think Peter's.
Peter was next. Okay.
Yeah, you had a graphic up there before. I think you called it the composite open space. Page, can you, yeah. The In looking at your package, it struck me that I was aware this was sort of spliced on to the Spurwink Farms Cottage Brook subdivision, so it's almost in a sense an extension of it, and I realize it's going to have to stand on its own feet. But could you just walk us through the developed portions of the Spurwick Woods Cottage Brook and how that relates both in terms of traffic, and I agree with Jonathan's point that I think that has to be carefully considered, but also even on the open space and trail network, if there is a sort of a consolidated feeling for what that's going to be like, I think that would be quite helpful.
Sure. Maybe start with the roads first. This is a subdivision portion of Spurwink Woods up through here. This is the condominium portion that Joel acquired and is currently building. The green through here and through here, I believe, is all part of the open space for Spurwink Woods. Did I get that right, Maureen? Pretty close?
Yes, and there's also some on the right side of Astor Lane around the condos that
Here? Yes. So that is all part of the Spurwink Woods project. The access roads that come in through Spurwink, Astor Lane,
not South Street.
No, it's Hamlin. I can't read that from here. Hamlin Street. It kind of comes in and currently dead ends at the condominiums right here. So that's the only way into the development. When we build this road, it will provide a looped neighborhood interconnectivity and providing that additional access, which we think would be of benefit overall for emergency vehicles, for access, for traffic, alleviating some of the construction traffic, the connections between all the neighborhoods. A lot of work has been done around the desire to interconnect neighborhoods. So the open space around Maxwell Woods is in magenta. And that magenta connects up against the Spurwink Woods. The Spurwink Woods, I believe, is owned by the town. Is that correct? We're proposing, at least at this point, to make this owned by the town over here around the four-unit multiplexes. This would be private as part of the association for the Maxwell Woods condominium portion. However, there is a trail that comes around like this, crosses the road. I think it comes up through like here, and there's another trail network that runs around like this. We are proposing to link into that trail network, come down around here with a trail network, come back up to here. There's a sidewalk that we're building on the extension of Astor Lane, and to build a connection from this network over to Astor Lane to try to provide some additional loops, some different options, and availability of trails within that area. And those trails would be public trails with a dedicated public easement over those trails. I can't tell you, this showed up on the map. Is there a trail through there now?
We're working on that.
Okay.
And that is, that's an approximate location.
Right.
But the Conservation Committee and the Town Council in December accepted a license agreement from the Canterbury and the Cape Association so that there are some existing trails in there that the town is now agreeing to manage. And I was actually out there last Thursday night hammering up little blue diamonds, starting to mark those trails and manage them.
And then over here, there's another unique opportunity. I know that Canterbury Woods is working with, has been discussing with Maureen, the connection of some of a trail network through here across their property. I can't tell you where that's at. Or
and this, if you could just wand up north-south.
North-south,
right,
like this?
Stop, go back to the left, stop, go straight up. Straight up. All of that land is now part of the license that we have agreed to with Canterbury. So there will be another section of trail that will be added that will connect up to Mitchell Road.
Okay.
And it's informally there now, but it really needs management.
Okay.
And I'm just going to recognize the members of the Canterbury and the Cape Association that are here that have been wonderful to work with on that trail management.
Peter, did I cover
yes,
that
did.
Okay?
Thank you.
Okay.
Jonathan?
One just thing to clear up with regards to my statement about the traffic study. I know you said that you're going to look into different demographics with regards to the traffic study, but what I would like to see with the traffic study is taking into assessment the fact that, from my count, just going around the lots around the Franklin Circle area, which is along Astor Lane, all the way up to the new condominiums that are being built right now, that's approximately 39 units right there. So 39 plus 38, I would like to see a traffic study that would take that into assessment, given I know that this is just an application for the Maxfield or Maxwell Woods. However, given the fact that you are going to connect those two roads, I think that I would like to see a study with regards to that amount of traffic from those units. And also we had a statement from the public today that said that that neighborhood has a lot of children too. So I think we need to see a traffic study that doesn't just take into consideration a 55 or older crowd.
Thank you.
Victoria, did you have something else? Are you
not on completion, but I
thank
do
you.
Have a lot of questions on
I'm just yeah, okay. Do we have any questions on completeness for him? I know there are going to be many more on the other, on the rest of the topics. So okay. So based on what we've heard here tonight and the materials we've had, are we ready to take a vote on completeness? Would someone like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Jonathan?
Motion for completeness. Be it ordered that based on the plans, materials submitted, and the facts presented, the application for Maxwell Woods LLC for major subdivision review and a resource protection permit for Maxwell Woods, a 38-unit condominium and 8-unit apartment development located at 112 to 114 Spurwink Avenue be deemed complete with the following waivers of subdivision. One, waiver for submitting a plan at the scale of 1 equals 40 and instead a plan at a scale of 1 equals 60. Waiver two, waiver from submitting a soils report and a lot-by-lot suitability analysis and high-intensity soils survey and instead connection to public sewer and wetlands mapping.
I'll second.
Okay, Victoria seconds. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Abstaining? All right. So now do we want to have a site walk? Do we want to wait till after the snow tomorrow melts, or do we want to go? What are we looking at for? Oddly enough, I can say, other than Tuesdays and Fridays, I'm pretty wide open.
Probably weekend.
Weekend? I know. I can't say that in the summer, but I can say that right now.
Wednesday mornings?
I could do
I can't do a Wednesday morning.
Weekends?
It's Saturday. I know the weather
Saturday.
Actually this weekend is supposed to be
early.
Pretty nice.
Saturday early? What time's early, Joe?
7.
Yeah, 7.
Remember, it is winter.
Is it light on 7?
We do 7:30.
It was light at 5 tonight, so
I have plans on Saturday, so I just want to make sure that if it's Saturday.
Can we compromise on 7:30?
I'm fine with 7:30.
Or 8. I mean, 8 I can do.
Okay, 8 would work.
Oh, we went with 8. We're going
this
with
coming,
8.
This coming Saturday?
This coming Saturday at 8 o'clock.
All right. Well, grudgingly, yeah.
So that's the 21st.
8 o'clock, you said?
Saturday the 21st at 8 o'clock.
Where do we park?
Where shall we meet you? Can we get permission from the Bamfords to meet down in there, or is that not efficient?
I'm looking at Joel. He's probably got a better answer.
At the end of Astor Lane?
What's that?
Yeah, can we meet at the new condo?
Can we meet at Cottage Brook right at the end of where the road ends right now? Cottage, because there's nobody living in there, and we've got roads in Cottage Brook, so there's
so right
plenty
at the
of
end of Astor Lane?
Yeah, that'd probably be the best place to meet. And so I'm going to get my surveyors. I assume it would be helpful to I'll mark out the road, the approximate center line of the road through both of them. And the buildings are so close, if you walk along the road, you'll know the buildings are within 20 feet of the road. So is there any...
Do you have the lines, property lines?
I don't know if the lines or the Bamfords actually are the ones that had the property surveyed, and I don't know what the original surveyor did for lines, but...
So I think it would be helpful to see some of the trail that's going around the perimeter.
If we have the road in, that should... Joel, you've walked the trail. What's that? The pens are all in on the property?
There is a decent amount of trail already.
In the right location?
That's...
Depends. We'll find out. Where are your boots? Go ahead.
I was going to ask, would the board find it useful to at least have a decent idea of where the closest corner is for that first unit on Maxwell Woods and the last unit on Maxwell Woods, and maybe two of the corners on the apartment building, just so we can get a sense of where the buildings are?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Is that something you'll be able to do?
Yeah.
Okay.
So the two corners, so that's...
I'm thinking the closest corner of each apartment building.
Oh, down here?
No,
oh, no, the apartment building.
Pick
yes.
One of those corners as close
yes.
to the road so
okay.
that we have a sense of where that is.
Yep.
And then one of the corners on the top unit in the beginning of Maxwell Woods.
Oh, like up here?
That one, yeah.
Okay.
And then one on the bottom.
Yep.
Okay.
Would you like on the bottom one, maybe down here or something?
I was going to say on yeah. the other end so you
here?
Know how close it is.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And where do we meet for this?
You're going to drive in on Astor Lane. So you're going to come in.
The only way.
Well, you could park by the pond and try to get in that way too, but it makes more sense probably to start where the road ends.
Okay. I'd be happy to offer my driveway if you want to park there on that Saturday morning as well.
Maureen, I'm sorry, where do
the
we...
The very end of Astor Lane.
Where's Astor Lane?
Very end.
It hasn't been built yet, has it?
Part of it there where it ends right now. You come in...
Yeah, you got to come in.
Oh, you got to come in through the back.
Come in from Spurwink, you make the right turn onto Stevenson,
yep.
and then you make another right turn onto Hamlin,
Hamlin.
And then you make a left turn onto Dermot, and then you make a right turn onto Astor, and you drive until you run out of road.
Yeah.
Yes, Victoria.
Are we ready to go forward for substantive discussion?
I think so. Okay. All right. Next step is for the board to pummel Owens with questions and concerns and things that we want to see.
Done a pretty good job so far.
Yeah. Oh, all right, Victoria, go.
Okay, I'm going to start with the plat. I'm going to also be looking at the town engineer's letter. I'm going to be looking at landscape, and I'm going to be looking at some of the sheets that are in here. So I'm going to start with the plat. Okay, in the plat, I had a really hard time figuring out this plat. I was reading the deeds, and the deeds talk about parcel A, parcel B, B2, and B3. Would you be willing to label B2 as B2 and B3 as B3?
Sure. That must be how it's broken out between the Littles and the Bamfords, so yeah. Yes, we can do that.
Okay, that would help reading this. Okay, and then I want the record of owner, the total area of each of those parcels, because that's how the deeds read, and it's just so difficult when you label them as Area 1, Area 2, when everything is referred to as B2 and B3. Okay, thank you. Now that smaller pond, I didn't know what that was at first. Can you label it as a pond? And I think I heard you say it's RP2?
It's
RP1.
That's RP1.
Oh, can you label
it? It was RP2, but I can label that.
Yes, you can. Okay, so the small pond.
Yes.
Am I being clear? The small pond, I want it labeled as a pond. I want it labeled as RP1.
Okay.
Now this wetland that's located way in the corner.
Yes.
What is that? It's not labeled either. What is that?
That is an RP2. And you can
Thank
label
you.
That.
Yes, I'd like that label. Thank you. Okay. Now it did come up about the affordable housing units.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in our plan, it does say you can't just put them in one section. You've got to disperse them throughout. So I would like to know where you're going to be putting your affordable housing units, because they do need to be dispersed. You can't just stick everybody on the end and get them out of the way. You need to disperse them through, and let's be kind and generous. I want you to label Astor Lane. There's absolutely no label on the plot. Okay. I want you to label the units as either single-story, single unit, or duplex, or quadruplex. There's no labels about what building A is, building B. Just some more, so we know what we're looking at. Can you add the word drive to Maxwell Woods Road? So we know it's Maxwell Woods Drive?
Right.
Can you add the book and page to Cottage Brook Subdivisions label? Can you add the book and page to the Canterbury Hills Subdivision label? Can you add the book and page to the new Bamford lot? Would you correct the spelling of Petrina Owen's name on the plat?
Okay.
And if it would help with some of the spacing, you've labeled everything as Cape Elizabeth Main 04107. I think that's a given. And so if you'd like to, unless the board disagrees, I don't see if spacing becomes an issue that you need to keep.
Oh, I see.
You see what I'm saying? Everybody's labeled as Cape Elizabeth Main, and I think that's a given. Unless the board disagrees, they would like to see that label. I'm okay if you remove it.
So we would take off Cape Elizabeth Main.
04107.
Yeah.
If that helps with your spacing, it's not a demand, it's just a suggestion.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, in regards to this unit option detail, you see that it shows the what your duplex will look like? You mm-hmm. see what I'm looking at? Okay.
Yep.
Do you see how it says C note 20?
Yes.
Okay, I think you know what I'm thinking.
Yes.
There's no note 20.
That note.
Okay, so note 20 was on your last renderings. And I'd like to see you add the same note 20 that you had on that one, which read, duplex units shown include optional sunroom and office. These features may or may not be built depending on the owner's preference or may be interchangeable. Location of features may change depending on which options are selected. That's what your note 20 was from your last. Would
the
you be willing?
Notes should be on there, yes.
Okay, thank you. Unless, once again, the board doesn't want to see that, but that's what it read. Okay. And now this one, this is, it looked like a cut and paste because it says that you have an optional deck, patio, and screen porch. Is that the option now, the optional deck, patio, screen porch? I thought it was optional deck and patio. No, everyone gets a patio. So it's an optional deck and screened porch, but everyone gets a patio?
Joel, is that the base? It varies from unit to unit, right?
Joel, would you like
to? Yeah, you'll have to come up here.
It looked like everyone got a patio, but please clarify.
So what I think what Victoria's asking is, so everybody that do all the units automatically get a patio as the base unit, or does?
They do, but remember this L right here?
Yeah.
Is could be anything. Could be patio, could be, it's made basically a building envelope. And it could be an office, it could be a sunroom, could be a den, could be a patio, can be a screen porch.
You see how that cross-hatching basically
yes.
forms an L on each side?
Yes.
Those could basically be anything. It could be a den, it could be a patio, it could be a deck, it could
so
be a
So the patios
porch.
Are optional? Because they didn't look like they were optional in your renderings, your elevations. I mean, if it is, if it's not, I'm just trying to clarify.
The patios come with a standard unit, but at that patio location, you can actually add at the time of building or a few years down the road or maybe.
So will you be building patios?
I'll be building patios on every unit, yes.
Okay, so it's not
optional? Do you see people actually saying, I don't want a patio?
Sometimes the patios are switched out for a screened-in porch or a deck.
Or it could be a deck.
Okay. Is the deck?
So if you were buying one of my units, you could say, I don't want that patio there. I'd rather have a den.
Yeah, the den's inside the building, not outside of the building.
At that patio location, you can, it's more or less a building envelope that you could do a patio, you could do a den, you could do a bedroom, you could do an office.
So it is true that the deck, patio, and screen porch, and den are all optional?
Sunroom, all that whole L.
Okay, then you'll want to add in the den is optional. Oh, you do have that down there, optional den, okay. All right, so.
It's a little confusing, but
it is a little confusing.
I'm open for suggestions to make it.
No, if that's, it looked like everyone got a patio in your further sheets. If that's an option, then that note is correct, and just make sure the other sheets make sure it's optional.
We'll clarify it.
Okay, from that same, when I went to go find note number.
Excuse me, Victoria, what sheet are you looking at while you're asking these questions?
2 of 30, I think. Are you on
You're in the
30?
Small sheets?
No, big sheets.
The big sheets.
Okay.
Did you find it before I try to open it up? I mean, there's not much.
That's right, you can help me there.
No. People, excuse me. Discussion's up here. If you need to discuss something, you can go outside, please. But you need to hear things up here.
Where is said optional deck? I can go back to that.
I'm talking about that.
If he says it's off, no, I'm not talking about that. It's in here where it shows. I don't have the exact sheet. But I can move on. He says they're optional.
That's fine. When you're asking your questions, if you could let us know what sheet you're asking your questions on so people can follow along more easily.
And I will just work with the applicant to make sure it's as clear as can be for the next time you submit.
So we're good on the optional for the moment.
I was wondering if the applicant, and then this is a question maybe if the board wants to also pipe in, but when I was looking at this note 20 and I pulled up those old plans, I also saw that there was another note and you put into that plan 20% of the tree budget shall be reserved and held by the town until the end of the year 3. After the trees have been planted to pay for replacement of trees that die. Now you put that into an other plan. I don't know how the board thinks about that. I thought it was a great idea, and I'm just wondering about
the
board.
What was the purpose? That was the original developer.
That was the original. Oh, that's the Cottage Brook. That was the original developer that had that in there.
It wasn't you.
Joel ends up doesn't turn these associations over for several years until they get built out to at least 50%, is that right? 75%? So he ends up being responsible for all of that until that
Excuse
period
me?
Of time. But
could I make a comment?
Yes.
I think one of the reasons he's confused is that the Cottage Brook plans aren't their plans. They were a different developer. But what I would suggest is the board knows that you've adopted a new subdivision ordinance that has a whole new tree, Appendix C, and it was my intention to take the next set of plans that are submitted by the applicant and ask the tree warden to comment. And I'm thinking that perhaps we may want to delay the final details on the trees until after we hear from him.
Yeah, I agree with that. Would the trails be field located in consultation with the Conservation Committee? Does that normally?
The Conservation Committee, excuse me.
Go ahead.
Okay, good. The Conservation Committee looked at this plan at their meeting last Tuesday night. They know that they will be providing you comments at their meeting next month, which is February 14th. They've already made comments about the trail and have already said that it is their intent to recommend that exactly what you just said, that the trails be located in consultation with the Conservation Committee. They also noted that they have worked with this applicant to locate trails in Eastman Meadows, and they were comfortable that he was very cooperative in meeting their expectations. So their concerns are low, they want to be involved, but they've had a very beneficial relationship up till now.
Thank you. I also was looking at your legend because I was trying to highlight what property is the building envelope and what is the property line. And I was having a hard time distinguishing between your building envelope and the property line. How do they differ? My eyes couldn't pick up on that. How do they differ?
This would be sheet 2 of 30, I believe.
I'm on sheet 2. I'm sorry. This whole time I've been on sheet 2 because it's going to be submitted to Cumberland County Registry of Deeds. So I'd like them to be correct.
We can show them as...
Do they differ? I mean, is it...
No, they're the same because we looked at them both as essentially property lines differentiating between what is the open space and what is the development area. But we can use, I can change the symbols. We can use the symbols differently. We could
it was
do
confusing. I was trying to...
Yep.
I took out my marker. I'm like, what am I looking at? And I'm like,
they're pretty standard. I mean, just based on my experience, what he shows is pretty standard.
Okay, they look, well, they're exactly the same, he just admitted. And so I had a hard time telling between the building envelope and the property line.
I can
but
see
if the
if
rest
we can
of the
change
board
the line type.
Doesn't
seems,
matter.
It seems fairly clear to me, because I guess I'm used to looking at it.
Whatever you'd like to do then. Now, this is kind of a typical note. Would you be willing to add a note, and once again, looking for board, the town of Cape Elizabeth shall not be responsible for the maintenance, repair, plowing, or similar services for a private road, Maxwell Woods Road, shown on the plan, or some kind of similar wording. The town's responsibility for the private road? Okay. Would you be willing to add a note about the performance guarantee, something such as road construction activity cannot commence until performance guarantee had been provided to the town in accordance with section 16-2-6C of the subdivision ordinance?
I think that's a standard condition. Is that a standard condition of approval, Maureen? I mean, I can add those to the plan, but I think, remember...
What is the standard condition of approval?
For the performance guarantee?
Yes, and... The performance
thank you.
Guarantee, get back to my microphone, so talk if they're not here. The bulk of the performance guarantee stuff is handled as part of the final approval. So because this is a major subdivision, there's preliminary approval, and then there's final approval. And as staff, I would really be focusing very hard on performance guarantee stuff at the final approval phase.
So it does not need to be on the plat? It's
I would say not right now, because okay. You can't do anything, even if the board, you know, decided next month to approve this, you can't do anything with this unless you get final approval. So, I always think of final approval in the way your ordinance is structured. Final approval is really the I dotting, T crossing, making sure all the deeds are written, make sure the performance guarantee estimate's done, looking at the instrument, and that's when, you know, we would want to put that note on here. But honestly, even if there is no note on here, under the ordinance, you cannot start construction without a performance guarantee.
How about this, Maureen? how about a note that says a fee shall be paid to the town's stormwater compensation fund and utilization plan upon approval by the MDEP?
And that's the Troutbrook.
Troutbrook.
That's the Troutbrook comment he made. And I like to think that I'm pretty diligent about making sure that anyone who owes the town money always pays it. So okay. I don't know if we need the note on there. My guess is it should be at least a condition of approval, and then it would end up as a note on the plan anyway.
If it helps, the DEP won't give us our permit until the check's submitted. So
exactly, we have collected this once before. So,
we're pretty well motivated to write that check, or Joel is. Sorry, Joel.
All right, I'm not sure if I saw a note about who prepared the wetland delineation. Typically,
we can add that.
Yeah, typically there is a note added that with the date of the documentation.
Sure.
This is something that we've been adding to our plans. Would you be willing to add a note about activity outside of the building envelope, such as
Activities outside the building envelope are restricted to the installation of driveways and the installation of utilities. No vegetation shall be removed outside the building envelope except as follows. Hazard, meaning dead or storm damaged trees in areas outside of the building envelope, may be removed after consultation with the code enforcement officer. And did I get that wording? Yes.
Respectfully, this is a unique situation where that particular note, I don't think we need, because every bit of property that is not going to be under control, that is not supposed to be developed, that would be fall under that note, is actually going to have a conservation easement on it. And so that language is actually going to be replaced by a deeded easement. So all of the land that will be retained by the condo association as open space, there will still be a conservation easement that will have to be written to cover all of that land, and the town would hold, either the town would hold the easement or it would be in the deed for the condominium association. So that's going to cover all of the land around the condos. And then the agricultural conservation area will probably be a separate deed, again, a conservation easement, and that will specify what activities could be allowed there. And then the third piece, which is the piece that's on the east side of Astor Lane, where we're learning that the applicant is proposing to donate that to the town. And again, it would have conservation restrictions on it. And if you look at these lines, there's just nothing left outside of these open space areas. For example, you know, on the Astor Lane piece, it's just mere feet away from the parking lot. So there's not really a lot of place where they can't do anything. I mean,
yeah. My concern, this is why I would bring this up, is I'm looking at the condominiums on Maxwell Woods that are right up against the Cottage Brook subdivision. So I was looking at those, and I was looking how close your property line is. It's, I don't know what the footage is on that, from somebody's back window to the property line.
That's the property line. That's the building.
The building envelope? Okay, right. Property line, building. So my concern was, if this is the property building envelope, and I'm proposing that no activity, no clearing occurs, I do want that in writing, because I'm very concerned that if I lived here, I'd probably want that mowed. I probably wouldn't want a tree right up against here. So
yeah
I'm concerned that they're going to push their lawn into the open space.
I would make two comments. One is, I've also spoken to the applicant and expressed the same concern that there needs to be physical markers that are obvious for everyone to show where these areas are, and we had talked about boulders. So we're looking at a way to really mark these well so that we don't have those incremental encroachments. That's the first thing. And the second thing is, I actually went out last summer to monitor an easement the town holds for conservation adjacent to a very mature condominium project in Cape Elizabeth. And what I learned was they hadn't encroached at all. And I think I came to the conclusion it's because condominium associations pay people to mow their lawns. And so they only pay them to mow exactly where they're supposed to mow. But yes, we would have to, I think it's a good idea to make sure that there are ways to avoid encroachment, but we have less problems with encroachment with condominium projects.
Okay, that was a concern, thank you. I couldn't find the distance between each of your buildings on any of your sheets, so I don't have a specific sheet I'm looking at. But is there, Maureen, a provision in our ordinance that says the distance between each building shall be at least the height of the tallest building, like on page 152?
Well, it sounds like there is.
And I'm just wondering, what is the space in between your buildings? I couldn't find it on any of the sheets.
What is it? I think it's 30 feet between the buildings.
Okay, I'd like Maureen then to check this out.
And these are all single, well, except for the apartment. These are all single-story buildings.
They are.
As you said, mine's on page 152, and this is in section 1972, which is the open space zoning provisions, which, by the way, has all your new multiplex housing standards. If the development consists of multiple buildings on one or more lots, the plat shall show the proposed location of each building. Buildings shall be located so that the distance between any two buildings is at least equal to the height of the taller building.
At least equal to the height of the taller building. So it can't be closer than the height of the tallest building.
And you measure the building using the height definition that we already have that allows you some peak. Right.
Right.
And so would that building would be the apartment buildings?
I believe you could apply this to condominium buildings as well.
Okay. I took it to be because it said that the wording was taller of the...
Oh, well, I'm thinking that if you have two buildings that are next to each other, any two buildings that are next to each other, you have to be...
At least
35? Those two buildings have to be far enough away that it's... The minimum distance away would be the height of the taller of any two buildings.
Of any building within the entire development?
Within the entire development. So
the tallest building is the apartment, which is 35?
No, you base it based on whatever the two buildings are. So for example, you have building C and building D.
Mm-hmm.
You measure the distance between building C and building D, and that distance has to be at least... The minimum distance has to be at least as tall as either building C or building D, whichever is the taller of the two buildings.
So I'm not sure the height of those buildings. I don't have that off the top of my head. How tall are they?
Boy, they're under 30 feet, Joel, from the condominiums. No,
but keep in mind, when it varies, because you measure the height from original grade.
Right.
So if you have, you know, on grades, you're just going to have to work it out.
Okay.
You measure the height from average original grade to the center of the attic. And the 30 feet's fine, but we can.
Yeah, I just want it shown somewhere on one of the sheets, on one of the elevation sheets, the height of, or the distance, I mean, however you want to do it. But when the code enforcement officer goes out with this plan, he has told us many a time, I don't want to go researching information through these books. He's told us many a time, put it on the plat, so when I walk out there, I don't need to have memorized or try to find it in here. And so that's why I'm asking for you to just put the distance between them.
Sure.
Okay, that was questions I had on the plat. Now I got some questions, general questions.
Sure.
How many, because, okay, now I think I know the answer to this because now you've told me that your single units are just a one side of this. So I had a question, how many bedrooms? Two.
Two.
Yeah. Okay, and the duplex is two. And the quadruplex.
Actually, there are three bedrooms.
Oh, and the duplex?
Well, the singleplex and the, so each unit.
No, the quadruplex has three?
Well, there's no quadruplex. Oh, you're talking about the apartments. I'm sorry.
I can call them apartments. It's better than quadruplex.
Yeah, quadruplex or, I don't know, the two-story multiplex, I guess, is the correct term. But, okay, yes, those are two. Second floor is each one of those units has three bedrooms.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure because it's not really, you have to go to the
floor plan, yeah.
Yeah, look it up. Now, how about the proposed location of electrical utility boxes? Will those be eventually shown on here?
Yeah, James had asked that question earlier. Yeah. What we do is once we have the layout down, Joel sets up a contractor, gets a number with CMP. The power company send it to them. They'll do an electrical layout, tell us where they need to do it based on locations, and then. But it'll all be underground, but they will be ground-mounted transformer pads, generally in between a couple of units, and they have services run to each unit back. But that will show up on the plans.
That will. Thank you.
Okay. Are there going to be any standing mailbox areas for Area 1, as you call it, Area 2, as I call them, B2, B3? You proposing to put out a structure for the mailboxes?
Yeah, we generally have a clustered mailbox, right? And it'll be, we'll add that location, but it'll be right on the drive coming in, and it's a aluminum mailbox on a pedestal.
Yeah,
that people,
I just couldn't find it, and I was wondering if,
yeah, we haven't shown it yet. Joel actually usually needs to talk to the postmaster, I think, and there has to be a discussion around that.
All right. Are you going to have any sign that says Maxwell Woods?
Yes. Again, that's going to be, as we go along, Joel's usually does some sort of a nice rock or stone sign. And did you, do you have one in mind at this point?
We put a site sign for the construction, but there is no plan to put a permanent Maxwell sign.
Oh,
I'd
okay.
like to do my entrances of my projects a little less loud, just to have some nice landscaping, rock walls, that type of thing.
So instead of the, wait, did I hear you say you will be doing rock walls or you won't?
We'll be doing rock walls throughout the project, and usually at the beginning of my project I'll do something with some landscaping and stonework, but no elaborate sign.
Okay, like Stonegate has
will,
elaborate sign.
Right.
Or,
okay. The Eastman Meadows project, there's a note on the plan where the association could put one in if they would like to. So as long as a note on the plan, they don't have to go back to the planning board to put something out.
Do we normally look at the signs and so I don't know if that's okay with the board for put a note that they can put a sign up, just something to think about.
Well, I believe there's a note on the plan of the Eastman Meadows saying that it can happen with permission from the town. I mean, with
so showing. You're proposing to add that note then?
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine.
I made a note to add the note.
Are you proposing to have any sidewalks along Maxwell Wood Drive? And I would say this is under section 19-7-2D3B, page 154, under pedestrian safety, and that next page 155, pedestrian circulation. I'm just wondering, Maureen, maybe you can jump in here about how, I know there's a sidewalk on Astor Lane, but does there need to be a sidewalk? I mean, will the people be going out into the street to walk around? Is there a provision on that, or is that for the board's consideration?
Well, it's not a public road. It's a private road. And if you look in the ordinance under the private road section, it explicitly says that you do not have to install a sidewalk on a private road.
Okay.
So, you know, unless the board has a compelling concern that a lack of a sidewalk will mean that this project will not meet the pedestrian safety requirement, the applicant doesn't need to put a sidewalk on.
Okay, thank you for explaining that. Okay. On sheet number 3. Would you be willing on sheet number 3 to renumber the plan from number 8 down? Can you see how it's out of order? From number 8 down?
It says 6, 7, 8, 7, 8, 9, yes.
Would you be really, yeah, you would have that?
Absolutely.
Thank you, okay. Is there a vehicular guardrail detail on your detail page? I couldn't find it, and if it's there, great, but I'm asking.
There needs to be one there if there isn't.
If it's there, I missed it.
What are you looking for?
The vehicular guardrail detail. The guardrail.
There's a guardrail detail. Back in the detail, I thought.
Okay, is there?
Wooden timber fencing.
Is that what it is? Is it the wooden fencing? Is that the vehicle guardrail?
I want to look to make sure, but Jim saw it, so.
Is that what you're proposing for the?
Yeah, it would be a timber guardrail with a, usually has a metal backing on it.
You've got a pedestrian guardrail in there too, I suppose.
Yeah, I wanted to make sure that, are they one and the same? Pedestrian guardrail is the vehicular guardrail?
So we have a pressure-treated wood vehicular guardrail.
Okay, which sheet is that?
Pedestrian guardrail. That may be associated with the apartment, with the outside stairs, but we're going to do away with that, so that probably won't be relevant anymore, that pedestrian guardrail.
Oh, okay. That's fine.
The vehicular guardrail, the pressure-treated wood, would be installed between at the edge of the road, right behind the curbing. It's interesting that the studies that have been done recommend the guardrails be right up against the curbing, not back from the curbing. And the reason for that is vehicles that hit the curb have jumped the curb, hit the curb, bounce up over the guardrail.
Oh.
So we usually put them, my traffic engineers tell me to put them right up against the curbing because of that, which is what we show on this plan. And that's wherever we have a retaining wall.
Oh, is there a picture? There's a picture of the retaining wall right there? I missed that too.
The retaining wall, we show two types of retaining walls. One's a modular block retaining wall, and that is on sheet. Let me make sure I send in the right spot here. There's a modular block wall that is on sheet 21 of 30.
Thank you.
And then next to it is a boulder retaining wall. There's also a boulder retaining wall. So generally what we'll do is, when situations allow, we like to try to use the boulder retaining wall. It tends to look a little better than the modular block, but there are instances where I have to do a modular block for stability.
Okay, thank you for pointing that out. I appreciate that. In your exhibit number 12 in your package, on the first page of exhibit 12, it says sewer service.
Yes.
I had to go over the bedrooms with me because I wanted, it says a two-bedroom apartment. It says number of bedrooms two, that eight units will be two-bedroom. Isn't that three bedrooms will be,
three bedrooms and 38 units will be two? What's that? Yes, that is correct. Three-bedroom condominium, so.
So it's backwards.
Condominiums are two bedrooms.
So it's backwards. Yeah.
Yeah.
Just FYI, that's backwards.
Thank you.
It'll probably work in your favor because now you have less units, so.
Right.
Yeah. All right. So I just wanted to point that out.
So much for spreadsheets.
Okay. Will the apartment buildings have any dumpsters? Will there be a dumpster back there?
Joel, what's your plans around that?
Good question.
Well, the town's got a transfer station, right?
I don't like dumpsters.
There's nothing in there that says you need a dumpster, but.
If you do decide to have a dumpster, you need to site it and pad it. So it's totally up to you.
Yep, totally up to you. I was just wondering. I didn't see anything. And those are the questions I have that don't go towards landscaping. So if anyone wants to have anything else that doesn't go towards landscaping, I'm going to do landscaping next.
Jim? Do you have any questions that aren't related to the topics that anybody have any other questions related to the topics that Victoria has been going over? All right, go on to landscaping, ma'am.
Landscaping, so I'm looking at sheets 16 and 17. Now, in the legend, you propose a symbol for the conifer and deciduous trees would be the same. This is busy, but now every tree is just a giant X instead of,
I don't know how the rest of the board feels, but it just makes it so much easier to read and to know what I'm looking at when I'm not just looking at an X. Is there a reason you went from distinct symbols to a X?
What the landscape, this is a landscaping convention that the guy, that folks do, but so like if you look at sheet 16 of 30, you'll see down by Spurwink Road, you'll see a 3BN, and then you'll see an X, and those, and it connects three of those circles with X's
right,
in it.
Right, yeah.
So those 3BNs are river birches, which I have to make some changes to this because of the towns. Maureen and I have already looked at this, so I have some species changes that I need to make because of the...
I guess it's more relevant when you look at sheet 17, when you get away from the trees on the side of the road. When you look within and you're trying to find out about the landscaping, all I see is the labels 3BN.
Yeah.
But if you just had a picture, it speaks a thousand words. If I just saw a picture, I would know, am I looking at an evergreen or am I looking at... So, I don't know. I was just throwing it out there. If you don't want to change it, that's...
Well, no, I'm just trying to... I'm always interested in readability of plans. So, if I... I'm not really sure I understand like when you say change... Oh, you're saying on the deciduous change the symbol so that the symbol itself looks different for a deciduous as versus I'll see what we can do.
Just throwing that out.
I'll ask him.
Okay. Now on, let's see. That is it. I'm going to go back to 16. Sorry. Now on page 16, you have a drawing of a typical unit.
Yeah.
But page 16 shows your apartments. That picture is not relevant to anything on this page. Would you like to show the landscaping around a typical apartment so that we would know what the landscaping is going to be around the apartments? Otherwise, I don't think it's in here.
Sure.
Because I would like to know what the landscaping for the apartments will be. So I can make comments on it. Right now, I don't know what it looks like. And so I am hoping that you are proposing some landscaping around.
I know that...
It's very bare. And this is where I'd like the board's comments, too, is there is absolutely no landscaping to, I don't know if it's north, south, east, or west, I'm going to say right side, if you're looking on sheet 16, not one bit of landscaping in that triangle between the other subdivision and the apartments. And I would like to hear what the board says, if that's okay with the board, no landscaping there, or...
There's actually a storm.
I'm on sheet 16.
Sheet 16, the footprint of the two apartment buildings.
Yeah.
That's this triangle right there, I think, is what you're referring to. Is it that triangle right there?
Yes. I'm looking at, this is your landscaping plan, and there's absolutely no landscaping whatsoever there.
I have to look at that carefully because that's where one of the underdrained soil filters are in that area. One of the, so that's, I can't have roots or trees in the underdrained soil filter, so
you can,
we'll see. So that area there is pretty much all consumed by one of these underdrained soil filters for stormwater.
Owens, can I just stop for a second? There's a level of detail also that needs to come at some point regarding landscaping on the... what's going to be cut, what's going to be saved on the perimeter of the property. And I would expect that that kind of information would be part of that because that is on the perimeter of the property. So I know that level of detail hasn't shown up yet, but I'm expecting that it will.
It will, yes.
And then we, at that point, can address some of the concerns about some of the old growth trees and which ones should be saved and which, you know, which ones we'd like to see saved and which ones the
will be replaced and so on and so forth, but, so that level on the perimeter is coming?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
That was going to be something I was going to point out, is we typically get a current, this is what the current landscape, and then the proposed, and we have all proposed, but I have no idea, typically, and they'll label, we just looked at something within town center, and they labeled the old growth trees, the ones that were very large, I have no idea.
Before we can give, go to the preliminary approval, we would need that level of detail. So, next phase.
So, and it is fair to say on our sidewalk, we might want to flag some trees if we see any that are seen worth saving, or that we would like to see saved.
I'm sure that's our place to do that.
I'm sure there will be some discussion on that at the sidewalk, so. Go ahead.
I mean, the plans right now have the little squiggly line, which we euphemistically call a tree line, and, you know, in lieu of it, I'm guessing that there will be some specific trees that the board says, gee, we really would like, is, can you save this, what's going to happen? But in a more generic sense, if we could get that little squiggly line to something that is dimensioned, so that we can say nothing's going to be cut within 15 or 30 or whatever the distance is from a property line, that might also get towards a little bit more specificity in terms of preservation.
Sure.
Now, under section 19-7-2E4C, it says, general site landscaping shall include transition areas from buildings to parking areas. So I'm looking at your apartment buildings, and I'm, once again, I'm looking for that landscaping that provides that transition according to our plans, and that would be on page 156, what I just quoted. Once again, that would have nothing to do with current. I see nothing. There's absolutely not a tree, not a bush, not a shrub, and we do say in our plans, you do need to show a transition area from the building to the parking area in your landscape design. I'm very concerned about how blank and empty this whole section is. All I see is a building, all the steps which will be going away in the parking.
There will be some specific, we plant, Joel always plants trees and ground plantings around it for appearance, so you'll definitely see more specific planting.
In that same section, parking lots shall be landscaped to soften the perception of the hard surface. So I'm just looking to see what your plans will be around something in that area, according to our zoning ordinance. Now, let's see, I'm going to change to sheet 17. In our ordinance, the same section I'm quoting, page 155, it says, private outdoor space for each dwelling unit shall be incorporated. So when I look at building R and unit 28 and building U and unit 33 and 34, I don't see how they have any private, this is what the code is asking for, private space. It seems no landscaping, nothing there. They lack, I'm just wondering, why do they not get landscaping? And same with unit 28, nothing. But our code does say private outdoor space for each dwelling unit. And this is under our landscaping. Yeah.
So with the condominium, or with this condominium, with the association, there's what we call limited common elements and common elements. And usually anything outside the building or anything outside of what's considered a limited common element, like a patio or a porch, is part of the common open space or part of the common space that the association owns. And the idea behind that is that it really confines the use and the activities around the building so that it stays in a presentable, nice manner so that folks aren't out, like in this instance, you couldn't go out into a spot and just start putting in a garden, or you couldn't go out in a spot and put up a, I don't know, a clothesline, or the association documents just don't allow for that. Everything, you'll have a porch that you can do whatever you want inside the walls. Mm-hmm. On the outside, the association maintains and takes care of it, right down to the siding and the roofing on the units. This, one of the interesting things about this project is if you look at the topographical plan, there's some fairly steep contours that will be cut in between the upper and the lower level, and we have some stone walls and rock walls already shown on the plan. Joel is looking at potentially doing more terracing work within that. So there will be these steep grades with rock walls and some terracing in there, and we're going to be looking a little closer at that. So behind units 34 and 33, I went to the grading plan. It's a fairly steep grade, 3-to-1 from just off the back of the units, a flat spot off the back up to the road. So there, as far as planting trees, it's pretty tough on those steep slopes to do much. But we'll look at it some more. Okay. See.
Can I just say one thing about the landscaping? With the condominium development, we've found that you can do too much. Once you do too much, the maintenance fees go up. So you try to do some landscaping's beautiful, makes the site look nice, but sometimes if it's too much, things get cut down a few years later because they're overgrown. And it raises the maintenance fees. The ground fee now, the grounds fees, is like $100 a month per unit. The more trees you plant, the more mulching you do, the more trimming. So you try to keep a balance of enough, but not too much. A lot of people are moving into these. They don't want a lot of maintenance fees. They don't want a $600 maintenance fee. They want a $300. The more plantings you do, the higher that goes, because the maintenance fees for plantings and trees is one of the highest. I mean, they're weeding, they're fertilizing, they're mulching, you know, and every little clump raises your fees. So we're really making an effort here to keep my projects aesthetically pleasing but affordable.
I really appreciate that answer. Thank you very much. It helps a lot. In your typical unit landscaping plan, I'm still on sheet 17.
Sure.
You have labels as you're going to put in a medium flowering shrub, a medium large flowering broadleaf, a small flowering shrub. Does the board want more detail, or is that good enough for the board? Because it doesn't say what's going in, it just says a medium shrub.
I'm satisfied.
I knew you would. Yeah. Anybody else on the board want more detail, or is that fine?
I'm not looking for any more detail.
Okay. Yep, no more detail, so that'll work. When you do go to put, when you find out where your utilities are going to be, page 155 says screening and buffering of above ground utility structures should be in the plan. So
mostly the transformer pads is what everybody focuses on. So once we have those, we usually do put some plantings around the transformer pad.
Or if it keeps the cost down, I've seen them hidden behind fencing, some type of fencing. Yeah. I mean, now that I've heard why exactly you don't want to put in a lot of shrubbery, I understand it a lot better now. But it does say in the plan, screening
you've done
and
that before.
The transformers typically go between the buildings. We don't want them in front of the building. We want them right in the between, so no one's actually looking at a transformer.
Okay.
So I like to have them placed. And we've asked, when I get the plan back from CMP and talk to Owens, I usually move them around a little bit if I can, because I want them in between the building. And then if they're really close and sightly, then we'll make sure we plant around them.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Now, in regards to, there's a whole new package, not this package, but the smaller one. This has your elevations in it. And I found it a little hard to refer to because none of these elevations have a sheet number or, I'm used to big sheet numbers.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
None of these, and some of them aren't even labeled. The first one says duplex, and then the rest aren't labeled. It's like what I had to figure out based on the number of bedrooms, what am I looking at? So labeling would certainly help.
Okay.
If you don't mind doing that?
No.
Is that okay?
Joel, we can get your CAD guy that's doing the buildings to, I'll give him what I want on him for markups and sheet numbers.
And so I have heard you say that you will be looking at the apartments to get that distinct front entrance that you'll be taking, it'll be internal now, those stairwells?
Okay. Yeah, there's going to be a change to the, go ahead, Joel.
Yeah, sorry. There won't be any stairwell in the front. There'll be that's gone, and there'll be a porch out front for each unit. And for each tenant, the stairway will be enclosed in the rear of the building. There's going to be a bump out in the rear of the building, which I'm in the process of getting all these plans redone. So there'll be no stairway in the front, and there'll be an enclosed stairway to separate stairway for each unit above in the back.
In the back, okay.
And in the back, we have a bump out for that, and the bump out roof will look similar to the gambrel style that you see in the front.
Okay, I'll
but we're working on getting some.
I'll be looking forward to that. Prior to learning that information, I was thinking of the 8-unit condos on Cottage Farms Road. It used to be an old school.
Okay.
You may remember this. Your company designed that building. It's 8 units, and ironically, this is.
I wish I could say I remember that. I'm sorry.
It was a few years.
He's too young for that.
It was 1982.
Thank you.
It was 1982, and when you talk about a distinct front entrance, it's nothing fancy. It was 1982, but it's not. It looks nice, and so I was going to say it's. You probably have the plans right in your computer somewhere, but it sounds like you're already working on it. But I just wanted to show something that's already in CAPE.
Okay.
It's very attractive, and we also have something in CAPE that's just on the other side of the road, the Woodland South condos. And if you ever just look on the other side, you'll see all those outdoor stairwells and how it's not attractive. So I'm thank you for working on that because we have a really good looking project and not so good looking.
Right.
Now on your elevations, I couldn't find that every one of them had the materials and colors. And I know you have the picture. And I appreciate the picture, but I also like to have, we've run into problems when we don't have our elevations well marked for the materials that may be used. If you could please just tell us the materials to be used, the colors, anything that you can put it right down on paper. Let's see.
Can we do that, Joel? Okay. You said yes.
Okay. I'm just going to throw this out. It's not in our plans. You ever thought about using concrete pavers for your sidewalks instead of asphalt? Just throwing that out there.
I have used pavers. I don't. Are you in the public way or on the building? Or around the apartment?
Yeah, around the apartment.
Okay. The public
just throwing
way.
It out there. I know you want to keep your costs down. They're a little bit more attractive than the asphalt. Totally your decision. It's not in the plans.
Well, the walkways to the condos are pavers.
Are they? Okay.
Yes. Not the sidewalk, but the walkways.
Yes.
Okay, and the walkway to the apartments will also be the same pavers. But
okay. Maybe I could
Not the sidewalk and not the driveway.
Yeah, I didn't note that on the plan, but I will.
Okay, it's not. That's why I missed it on the plan. Thank you. It's going to be much more attractive with the pavers. Okay. I think that might be it. I think you were missing though a couple of elevations.
Yeah, you're going to get back to us on the apartment, because you have the front, the left, the right, but you didn't have a rear. So when you return...
Oh, yep.
Yep. And I'm not sure if anybody else will go into that, but when you, before you present, just make sure we have all sides, all views. And then that was it, except for I wanted to go through, oh, do we need to have an easement for the private road? Should that be in the package, or is it?
For which?
The private road would be Maxwell Woods Road.
An easement, which would be part of the condominium?
Well, it's all part of the condominium, so the association owns and maintains it, so there would be no benefit on these.
Right, are you talking about an easement for the benefit of the public?
I thought we had to, okay, no private road.
No, I mean, the applicant is going to, it's usually as part of final approval, they're going to have to show how they're maintaining everything, and that will usually involve the review of condominium documents to talk about how they're maintaining Maxwell Woods Road.
Yeah, there is.
And stormwater.
I know I read something in here that had to do with maintenance of stormwater.
And then...
Both stormwater and the road.
Last thing I would ask is if the applicant could go through the town engineer's letter. I'd like to hear your comments to the town engineer's letters.
Oh, sure.
If that's okay.
We actually met with him. So on the letter, Astor Lane's public road, we designed it as 24 feet because we interpreted it as a different road classification, but we were corrected on it. It's not too often we get corrected. We're actually going to make it narrower, so that's going to be addressed in the next set of plans. We have a 7-foot wide esplanade. I think he was just saying it can be narrowed to 5 feet. We've tried to stay with a wider esplanade, and Maureen's nodding yes.
So you are going to go with the 7-foot
esplanade, yeah. It's better for the trees, I think, in there. So this was actually a comment. The item 5 was one we actually discussed when we were meeting with the town engineer at the staff's office about the tree spacing along Astor Lane. So on the side towards the pond, we show trees every 50 feet along that side of the pond, and there's a retaining wall there. We all collectively agreed there may be some concern in having those trees between the retaining wall and the pavement on that side. We're going to have some further discussion on whether we'd be better off to take those trees and plant them in some different locations, where they would be have a better survivability, and to maybe pick a few spots that those trees would work better in. And Maureen, I know, you know, we were going to meet with the tree warden, is that right, to talk about that, and so that's about note 5. The tree species, I actually talked about that a little earlier. The town has some very specific tree species. I'm looking at the trees we showed. Our landscape architect has picked a few species that I don't think are on that list, so we'll modify that to be on the list. The traffic we've talked about at a fair amount of length. We are going to be doing more work around that. The traffic light, Maureen noted in hers, we're going to take a look at an evaluation at that area and accident data. I'm not sure what to do about 9. The email and the letter from the Portland Water District shall specifically note the number of bedrooms and flow being accepted. We sent the documentation, and I can't really control how the Portland Water District writes their standard letters, but I'll see what we can do.
Can you at least send to us what you sent to them?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. That's all we need.
The typical road section does not meet town standard. That has to do with the 22 versus 24 feet, I believe. Was there anything else in that, Maureen?
You just need to fix it.
Yeah. And same with the sidewalk.
Yes.
We've been asked to add, the fire chief has asked to add additional hydrant on Astor Lane, which we'll do. That'll be in the next round of plans. The site distance should graphically be shown on the plans. I actually, when I met with him, I said that one thing we're going to do is do a little more topo, a little work around the intersection, and we're actually draw a section so that we make sure we have those site distances down there and how much of that ledge face we have to cut back. So that statement was kind of reiterating what we had talked about. Sewer and water shall be provided off Spurwink Avenue in the north of the lot. That has to do with, during our meeting, the what we talked about, the Maxwells wanted to have those stubs that we added to the plan. We did get those on after we met for the submittal. The Cottage Brook requirement requires an amendment to the connection of Astor Lane. So my understanding is that as part of this process, I need help from Maureen on this, but I think all we're doing is to make it part of the record that we're asking to amend the Cottage Brook condominium for the connection of Astor Lane. I don't think the right-of-way is already shown in the plans. Everything's already there.
There was also some fill changes that are right now temporary, and if you want to make them permanent.
Right, we have the request right. That. So it's more of verbiage, getting the wording into the...
Well, it's going to be a plan, too. So.
And a plan showing that, okay. So we'll make sure we have that. Design of the apartment building shall consider internal stairwells. We're obviously fixing that. Drainage easement shall be shown for outfalls on the abutting property. A couple of the drainage goes on to the Maxwell property, and we just need to specify drainage easements. And any deed restrictions shall be noted on the plan. The deed restrictions, I guess we'll have to figure out whether, because we have the association documents that we'll be generating that will have the restrictions around the association. If there are any, I guess I need to make sure I understand.
I can work with you on that.
Yeah, we'll put them on whatever we need to put on. Temporary markers for the site walk, so need to be shown. I'm going to lay out the center line of the road. We'll mark those building units when we go out on the site walk. I could show them. The center line's already shown on the plans, and the corners of the units are on the plans. I'll just give you a handout when we show up out there that shows you what we did lay out. Community impact analysis needs to be provided. Steve and I talked. We actually was in there. He just missed it on it, so it's not, you know, it's all fine. And then once we submit and we get into the more substantive or preliminary, I'm sure Steve will have some additional review comments that we'll work through with him. So.
Last comment? My last comment is I'm back on to sheet number 2. I'm looking at the plat that will be submitted. Your gross acreage of 17.66 acres, I couldn't add up the numbers to get that to work out. And I looked at 1.5 plus 0.62 plus, and I'm missing.
So when I started this presentation today, I had mentioned that we do need to make a change. I had actually double deducted for the, so Astor Lane has a right-of-way of 0.985 acres that's part of the project. So the 17.66 acres is actually 18 point something acres because I have to add back in the Astor Lane because I didn't add it in originally, but I deducted it. I have to add it in originally as part of the.
Oh, I didn't know you had to add it in because.
Well, the whole project. So I take the whole project area, and then I deduct the road, and then I deduct the Maxwell Woods, the physical driveway section of it. So that'll be updated to reflect all of that in the next submittal.
Because I know Astor Lane was 0.98 acres.
Yeah.
It's on that other plan you have. But I didn't know how long Maxwell Woods is because down here under unsuitable land, you got Astor Lane in there at 9.98, but you don't have Maxwell Woods. That would be an unsuitable, so that you also know
that,
you have to
go
back and...
So what happens is we've already sort of gone back through those numbers and it works out to the 46, but Joel was kind of excited at one point because it said he could actually have more units, but that's not true.
Okay, yeah, I couldn't get the numbers to work out, and I didn't understand that, so you already are on top of that, so that's great.
Thank you.
Done.
Thank you, Victoria. Anybody else? Any questions?
I have a question for Maureen.
Okay.
Can you remind me of what is the extent of our review on the actual buildings on this project?
You actually have a lot more review authority than you did when you approved Eastman Meadows and Cottage Brook. And we have those little pictures that we put in and the multiplex development standards, and actually left my book open, but just there are architectural standards. There's a standard for massing for roof.
So that would apply to the apartment?
It applies to everything, because the entire project is a multiplex development. So, you know, whether, just because the condos are going to be owned rather than rented, they're still multiplex. So every single structure in this project would have to meet these requirements.
Peter?
Maureen, could you remind us the pace of approval? On a major subdivision, there's a preliminary and final?
Right. What's going to happen?
What happens jumping?
Tonight, you made a determination of completeness. This Saturday, you'll go for a site walk. And then your next meeting isn't until February 27th. The applicants will resubmit plans probably the end of January. It might be February. I think February 3rd is the date. So there'll be a whole new set of plans, all changed, all perfect, with all these comments addressed, and that will be the subject of your public hearing. And then after you hold the public hearing on the 27th, you would again have another substantive review. You would go through all of these questions again. You'll have another letter from the town engineer, another memo from me. I'm hoping that you will have a memo from the from the Conservation Committee. You probably will hear from the fire chief. He has a lot of strong feelings about this road and the hydrant. You might hear from the tree warden. And based on all those comments, you would either table the application and ask the applicant to go back to make some more changes, or you could consider a vote for approval. And then once you vote for approval, then the applicant has to resubmit for final approval.
So the February or thereafter, the first level approval is the preliminary.
Yes.
And there is a chance for another layer of
right.
tweaking, so to speak.
In the ordinance gives you very specific guidance on this, but generally the preliminary approval is to get the overall concept approved, and then the final approval is really where we dig down on the dot the I's and cross the T's, because that's your last shot to make sure that what's on the plan is what you want built. So I wouldn't expect to see easement deeds now. I think the applicant's energy is best invested in getting plans in good shape. And then once you know that this is generally the concept, that's when you start getting the attorneys drafting up deeds for easement. You get your surveyors drafting up meets and bounds descriptions to cover the specific areas. Because if you do it now, those lines may change, and then you go back and change everything. There'll probably be a lot more detail on the road and the road construction at that point. So this is really more of are we generally in the right concept?
Likewise, construction, finished construction detail for the buildings, landscaping.
Yes, you would detail. Definitely that's, have another. Right. Absolutely, yeah. You want if the buildings are not heading in the right direction, now is the time to make the applicant aware of that. This is the time to say, I really don't like exterior stairs. Are those windows big enough to really meet our standard for entrance and windows? Is something you could leave till final approval, because you know you're really starting to fine tune at that point. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay.
I think that's the same one.
I guess that's the same on siding and that sort of thing. Because I thought we didn't have vinyl sidings in the town.
You do actually allow vinyl siding, and I was going through massing, roof, entrance and windows, exterior siding materials, and it does say, exterior materials shall be compatible with the design of the structure, shall be high quality and durable, the use of wood shingles, wood clavards, brick and stone is permitted. The board may approve high quality manufactured materials, for example, concrete clavards or siding, such as hardy plank that mirrors the appearance of natural materials. However, no use of concrete block, sheet metal, or aluminum siding is permitted. So vinyl siding is something that is allowed, and that was something that was discussed during these provisions and was added during one of the amendments.
I didn't realize metal was actually out.
Anything else?
I have a motion for table in a public hearing.
Okay, you can go right ahead.
All right, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application for Maxwell Woods LLC for major subdivision review and a resource protection permit for Maxwell Woods, a 38-unit condominium and 8-unit apartment development located at 112-114 Spurwick Avenue be tabled to the regular February 27, 2017 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing will be held.
Second, okay. Jim seconds. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? All right, unanimous.
Thank you for your time tonight.
Thank you.
See you Saturday.
Yes, Saturday. 8 a.m., right? We said.
Yeah, okay. Sidewalks are open to the public. You're welcome to join us at the sidewalk. If you have any comments, they would be put in writing and sent to the town planner. Public is not encouraged to speak at sidewalks, so but you're there, welcome to come and learn, listen and learn. All right, next item up on the agenda. Fusco Resource Protection Permit. Geraldine and Ernest Fusco are requesting a resource protection permit to alter 100 square feet of RP2 wetland to construct a 25-foot by 4-foot boardwalk at 11 Angel Point Road. Section 19-8-3 Resource Protection Permit Completeness and Public Hearing. We'll start with a presentation by the applicant.
Madam Chairman and ladies and gentlemen of the Planning Board, I'm Jerry Fusco, my husband Ernest Fusco. We live at 11 Angel Point Road. Angel Point Road is a right just before you get to Two Lights State Park. It is a private road, and we own an entryway onto Two Lights Road. Our land was originally had an address of Two Lights Road. We changed it legally with the town to 11 Angel Point Road. We're asking for requesting a resource protection permit to construct a walking path to connect one abutting neighbor to Angel Point Road. The total length of the path is approximately 100 feet, but of that part that we need the protection permit for is only a small 25-foot section at the very beginning of the wetlands. So there is nothing here. This property here is all landscaped beautifully. There is no direct watershed going down onto there. This part of the property is not wetland, so we were able to build there and do the path there and here because these are not wetlands. And we learned about that when we started into this. We started, we learned, first learned of the need for the path in October of 15, just after we moved in July 1st of 15. Then we learned about the need for the path, that the neighbors needed the path. So we've been observing this property, and we really do observe it because we were very concerned with all the, what we can do and what we can't do when we learned all about this when we moved in, because we have a lot of wetlands that were designated. In your plans, or in your packet, you have the a detailed site plan that was drawn by the surveyor who also did the wetlands assessment, the Alfred Frick people. We have a property deed. You have the locations and the names of the abutters. We do have a description of a soil evaluation and wetland delineation by Albert Frick that was done for the previous owner in June 2011. And I included a picture of this abutting property, which I had to take in the snow, but it does show that there are specimen trees here, nothing that would indicate there's any wetlands. Our path starts right here, just about at the boundary line between our property and the property in the front. And as I said, it's a very small area. We plan to, it is just, the area chosen has no constant standing water. We've monitored that very closely. All summer long, it was perfectly dry. The path over the wetland portion will be just pruned vegetation with organic matter left to lie on the path. We learned about this so that we could do it right. And the easement is only for one family of two people, and the foot traffic will be minimal. Our property is not divisible, or is the neighbor's property, so there won't be any additions on to either property to put more foot traffic. We wouldn't use this in general anyway, because our house is down here. Well, where they gave us the building envelope was here, so this is where we built our house, and we have a driveway right out to Angel Point. So the footpath is only for our neighbors. And we're requesting permit waivers because they're not of significance. A topographic map as a waiver, the location and flow of a water course because there isn't any, a stormwater runoff plan. There is no direct stormwater runoff on the wetlands. Any stormwater is on Angel Point Road or down in the ditch. And let's see, what else do I have to tell you? I think that's, we're not going to build any buildings, so we're asking for a waiver on the putting a building up. I think that's all you need to know. Is there anything else I left out? I can show you that, you know, this is where the neighbors are going to walk. Their house is over here, and their land is, they have a nice grassy area here that gives them a nice little path right to this little area here, and walk across to get to Angel, to get to the beach, the private beach of John Cove, which abuts actually the public beach that belongs to Crescent Beach. So all this land beyond here belongs to Crescent Beach, to the state, and so I guess that's about it that I can tell you. It's a very small area. It'll be about a 4-foot walking path and 4 foot by about 25 feet, so it's about 100 square feet.
On completeness, I'm first going to turn this over and allow public comment on completeness. So if anyone is interested, and this is, do we have the information we need to make the...
Yeah, I do want to, I just want to, I've left out the part about We're requesting the permit to allow for a boardwalk or mulch full if necessary, because that's what we were told that it's good to ask for in a permit.
So would anyone from the public like to comment on completeness? And you could keep your comments to 3 minutes. That would be great. So if you want to come to the mic and your name and address.
Do you want to take your documents, or do you want to leave them there?
You can look at them if you like.
No, thank you.
Good evening. My name is Ann Carney. I live at 21 Angel Point Road, which is kind of down here. My husband and I also own 23 Angel Point Road, which is a property right along the shore, and everybody in the neighborhood has a right-of-way to walk across our property down to the shore, and I've seen Ernie and Jerry many times walking down there. I'm not objecting to the right-of-way. I'm concerned about the completeness of the application. I used to own 139 Two Lights Road. I lived there from 1992 till 2004, and then I moved further down the road to 21 Angel Point Road. So I've been living in this area and walking up and down Angel Point Road since 1992. And particularly when I owned 139, which is now owned by the Woodworth family, I have been aware of the water situation. And then now, as somebody who drives up and down Angel Point Road on a regular basis, I see that there's a lot of erosion from stormwater running down Angel Point Road. And then since the Fuscos built their house, there's been a pooling of water right in this area. And so that causes me to be concerned about, over time, what will happen if right here, there's a buildup of a berm through leaving either mulch or vegetation in that wetland area. I think the Fuscos are assuming that there's not wetlands up here, but I think that this wetland delineation only applied to this lot. But if you look at it, you can see that there's just a straight line where the property boundary is. And I think that's because if one were to do a wetland delineation, you would find that rather than it just ending straight right there, I do think it goes into that. And that's consistent with my experience of owning that property. And so I'm just concerned that about the completeness issue. I think that the planning board should be working with all of the information it needs to understand how this footpath, which is filled with vegetation and mulch, will impact water flow and stormwater runoff. The reason I care so much is because I'm really worried about what's going to happen to the Woodworth property if there becomes sort of like a damming thing right here along their boundary. And I'm also worried about the drainage and the erosion that will happen on Point Road. Have you all seen the January 5th letter with the photographs that I submitted to the planning board?
Are you just about done?
Okay. So, you know, just in closing, I would note that if you look at the final photograph, photograph E, it shows boards laying across that low area where the proposed putting cut vegetation and mulch will happen. And I would just ask that we work with a water flow study and stormwater runoff plan so that the board can determine whether that's the appropriate way to do a crossing or whether it's better to have bridging, for example, like the town installed at Great Pond, which protects the wetlands and mitigates those runoff issues. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oops.
Anyone else who wants to speak on completeness on this project?
Hi, Paul Seidman, 21 Oakview Drive. I just had a hopefully very respectful question about an area that was identified as being dry all summer, in that we had close to a drought condition. So it just seemed like many areas that might be wet were dry. Thank you.
All right. Anyone else want to speak on completeness? Seeing no one, close the public hearing on completeness and go on to the boards.
I just did want to say that in the process of working on this part of the walkway, there was a lot of trash that had been thrown, and Ernie did use his wheelbarrow. In order to use his wheelbarrow in the area, he put down boards. The boards were only there for the wheelbarrow. They had nothing to do with the water. And unfortunately, the boards froze in place, so he couldn't remove them until they defrosted. So that's why the boards were there. It wasn't there for standing water.
Okay. Jonathan?
I actually have a question for you. Can you just explain to us and the public, there is an easement from your neighbor's yard with regards to an access through your property, is that correct?
That is.
And can you point out where that is on the map?
Well, the way this started was that we were presented with a 100-year-old easement which we didn't know existed. And the easement, there is what we thought was just an old driveway to the old house that was down here, Mr. Angel's house, apparently was an easement that was granted by Mr. Angel to this neighbor here, which we didn't know about and we weren't told. And the easement goes right through the building lot that we were given. We didn't choose the building site, we were given it, and the easement goes right through. So for the mutual benefit of the neighbor and ourselves, so that they wouldn't be able to access Angel Point, and they wouldn't have to walk through our house or driveway, that we met with the neighbors and came up with this solution. And then we met with Ben McDougall a couple of times so that we would do it right. And then we also had information from the surveyor, Mr. Schwanda, and the site evaluator, Mr. Frick, who assured us that, I didn't have direct contact with him. I had it with Ben, who had contact with him. So it was secondhand. We did our research to try to do it exactly right and to avert, not have any problems with the environment. I certainly admire all the work that Ann does and protects the environment, but we really do not feel that this is going to impact. The vegetation is permeable. It's, you know, just cuttings that we were told to do.
Okay.
So that was basically it. And also, this site survey does, if you look at the picture, it does show the delineation of the wetlands. You know, it's a little hard to figure out, but it does show it when they did it in 2011 for Judy Tizan, who sold us the property.
All right, thank you.
Okay, I have a question also. You've labeled this optional boardwalk. Are you looking for the board to decide
We were told that when you get a research permit, this resource protection permit, that the best thing to do is ask for the most, so that in case it had to be made. But the in case, I guess, would be if we were required to do it. We're trying to get a legal solution to this. And so in order to get a legal solution, we needed this resource protection permit. But apparently we didn't need it to build this walkway. But we're asking for it the most now.
Peter?
Yeah, Ms. Fusco, your neighbor mentioned the concern that a berm might result from vegetation being piled up in the footpath. What kind of vegetation are you, like, are you talking about a weed whacker cutting down grass and weeds, or are you talking about trimming branches?
I'm sorry, I can't hear you. It's just flipping.
But we need you to talk over there so that people can
okay.
hear you.
I'm sorry, but I couldn't hear it.
Yeah, that's okay.
It's clippings.
Clippings of what? I don't get it.
With the
shrubs.
A lopper or a hand clipper. We did what Ben said to do, was just trim the vegetation.
But it's like branches that would be growing over the footpath, or is it grass growing up off the ground?
You want me to help?
Yeah.
So I think if you look at the pictures that Ms. Carney sent, you'll see that it's a typical shrubby RP2 type of vegetation. And what they did is they trimmed the vegetation, so it still exists on the ground, but you can walk over it. And they just let the clippings that they trimmed drop to the ground.
That's it.
Nothing fancy.
Which may or may not rot.
Well, I would think they would definitely rot.
Okay, you know more about that than me. So that, when it, well then let me ask a question. If it rots, does it build up? Or does it just disappear?
Depends on what it is. How long?
But we're talking grass and weeds as well as twigs from the little things that are growing.
Yeah, it's not even grass. It's, you know, like a rough shrub, a very rough native.
It's mostly leaves there. There really isn't any grass there.
But as far as anything else on completeness.
And there are no big trees either, so, you know, the leaves that fall are just from those shrubs. I don't know what they are called. There is some winterberry, but I don't know what else is there.
Do we have any more questions?
Yeah, well, I have a comment. I mean, I feel like if they're proposing to do the boardwalk, I feel like it's a complete application. I feel like if they're proposing to do the path, I don't really know enough about a path on an RP2 wetland to make a decision about that. So I'm not sure that I would consider that complete.
Yes, ma'am.
The Conservation Commission reviewed this because it's a resource protection permit, and they were comfortable.
Okay.
With boardwalk and or
their feeling was that, I mean, the boardwalk spec is the exact same spec that they are putting in at Cottage Brook. Their feeling was that with the light, I mean, it's only one family that's using it, that this may actually be sufficient without a boardwalk, but there was also the feeling that if it got money, then someone would build the boardwalk.
And this is the type of boardwalk that we've approved many times for the Conservation Commission?
Yes.
This one?
Yes. Thank you.
Well, I don't think the neighbor's comment would mind the boardwalk, because that would simply not affect the flow.
But so the question really of completeness is, the concern is, without a flow study, is this complete? So what's the feeling of the board? Do we need more information, or are the waivers that the applicant asked for appropriate based on the information we have? Victoria?
I'm personally okay without the location and flow direction of any water course, pond, or standing water present for 2 months or more. Without knowing a little bit more, it just doesn't seem that there is flowing water or a pond. And number nine, the stormwater runoff. It needs to be prepared by a professional engineer showing pre- and post-developmental runoff. And I'm a little hung up on developmental runoff. If it doesn't seem to rise to something that we would ask a professional engineer to come in on, and I think that's why they were asking for the waiver. And so I'm okay with both of those. I just don't feel this pathway requires these, and I think that's why in the workshop we said we would be okay with waivers, but that's my personal.
Okay, Jonathan?
I'm satisfied also, because to me there is no development here. This is simply asking for a path that sounds like it almost exists already. The other concern that the neighbor had on Angel Point Road with regards to runoff down the road, I think that's a separate issue from this pathway that's being proposed, that's really doesn't even, it's not really sufficiently on Angel Point Road. It touches Angel Point Road at some point, but we're being asked for a 25-foot portion over the RP2 wetland, so I'm satisfied.
Jim?
I'm also satisfied. I do want to point out an error, top of page 3, no removal of vegetation is proposed, so no increase in erosion is expected. Just want to point that out, so, for the record.
We haven't gotten that far yet.
To me, this is
I was going to propose a motion.
Let's hear what Peter has to say.
Well, I think it's just confirmation. To me, this is a de minimis project, probably not requiring engineering.
And, right.
I would be comfortable with proceeding.
So, does someone want to make a motion for completeness or a completeness motion? You can make it complete or incomplete. I'm not.
Based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Ernest and Geraldine Fusco for resource protection permit to alter 100 square feet of RP2 wetland for a path/boardwalk located at 11 Angel Point Road be deemed complete and will include waiver of submission of the following: a topo map showing contours, a written description of the vegetative cover, the location and flow direction of water course, a stormwater runoff plan, and delineation of building envelope.
I'll second.
Okay. Any other discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? All right. Unanimous. Next step is a public hearing on the application itself. Is there anyone who wishes to speak? Do something odd, Anne, do you wish to add to your comments, or?
I'm glad that you found the application complete, because I know that it's important to the Fuscos to have this decided tonight. I would ask that in reaching your decision, rather than approving a path that is created by laying down cut vegetation and mulch, that you require a raised boardwalk that permits water to flow underneath of it. It's an important issue for people who live on Angel Point Road, because it's a private road, and so we have to pay for all of the road maintenance. And that's why I'm concerned about the runoff issue. And so I would just urge you to please require a raised boardwalk that allows the water to flow underneath of it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to comment? All right, public hearing is closed. Okay, now it's our turn to discuss this application. Anybody have any comment? Go ahead, Victoria.
I am looking at the pictures that Ann did provide. It's hard for me to tell by looking at this picture. Is this flat? Is this raised up at all? I can't tell, because probably there's snow and the snow highlights it.
Yeah.
If you could, from up there, you can use it and then comment.
Would it help to have a color version of that photograph?
Well, I would like the applicant to explain. Is this just flat, or is this already built up? I can't tell.
Angel Point Road is high. You know, the way a private road is built up, it's a dirt road, and there's a little bit of height here that had to be. This is not what we're asking for, because this is okay. Not on the this part here that you're looking at. The slope is not what we're asking for, because that's not wetland.
This is Angel Point Road.
Yes. Yes. Thank you. This whole area is not a part of our request that was built up.
Is this with the boards? Where's this on your property?
The boards where Ernie was using the wheelbarrow and he was working on the ends of the.
If you could go with the microphone over there, where is that? Where are the boards on your property?
Well, in this picture, they're probably right. They probably are right around here somewhere, because this is where he was working.
Okay, so that's not the area where asking for the resource protection?
A couple of them might be on the wetland area, yeah. It was delineated for us by the flags that Albert Frick had put there when he did the delineation. So there were blue flags tied to the bushes to show where the wetlands was. So, and then we measured it out
because we really couldn't tell which was wetlands and which wasn't. So we measured it out. And, you know, I guess in this picture that Ann took, the boards, some of them might have been on that wetland area, but as I said, they were just there for the wheelbarrow.
Once again, I'm sorry, I'm not quite following. You have a proposed path and optional boardwalk that's 100 square feet. Are those boards right there, those temporary boards, are those in that 100 square foot area? Are they?
They are in the path right now because that's what
in the area we're talking about.
Some of them are in the wetland area and others are off of the wetland area, but they are in the path. The whole path is 100 feet, but the resource protection permit application is only for the wetlands area, which is 25 foot. I am not sure exactly where these boards are, but some of them probably in this picture are on this area.
Okay, thank you.
You know, they're moved. He moves them as he moves the wheelbarrow. So.
Do we have our paper, Pat?
Yes. I'm sorry.
Yes, sir.
Yours?
I just think my initial impression with respect to your talk, we're blowing this way out of proportion. It's just a path to me, but that's my opinion.
I was just trying to get an idea of what I'm looking at from these photos.
I think we're looking at very flat land.
Is it that okay?
And a heavy rain might have some water run over it, but it won't stay there. And this is what I'm gleaning from all this information. And that a concern that if mulch and vegetation is used, that over time, not now, but over time, a berm will build up. That's a concern. And if that should happen, then they could run into some drainage issues one way or the other, because this is a wetland and water is draining through it. That's what I gleaned from all of this.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? Did I miss anything? What's the board's feeling?
Yeah, I mean, unless we want to wait till spring for sidewalk, which would be of no value today, to me, once again, it's a de minimis project. The Conservation Commission, with their expertise, seems to be comfortable. The only compromise I could think of would be to approve it and be able to require installation of a boardwalk if later on this berm effect happened. But I'm not sure that's something that we would get into in an approval, Maureen. Is that sort of a conditional approval, which may be a little bit beyond the scope of good practice.
Jonathan?
Without more information, saying that a boardwalk would be necessary, and based on the fact that the Conservation Commission sort of gave their seal of approval on this, I would be comfortable with not requiring a boardwalk at this time as part of a condition of approval.
Victoria?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's good practice either to say, the only thing that came to mind quickly, but I'm not sure if I'd even advocate this, is the Conservation Committee could look at this from time to time, or if there's a concern, or...
I'm not sure.
Yeah, so... Cool.
Well, respectfully, you know, the biggest concern we heard from the neighbors is when they thought it might be public. So I guess to give you a little perspective, all but Jim worked on the technical amendments, and included in the package amendments was a total overhaul of the site plan regulations. And you probably remember we took the stormwater requirement and broke it into three pieces. And we said if someone was going to add impervious surface that was under 10,000 square feet, that they did not need to have an engineer do a stormwater plan. And this is 100 square feet.
Thank you for that. I did miss all those meetings, so my apologies.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, I wasn't there for any of that, so I'm a little...
It's the only number I can remember.
It was a lot of discussion around it.
Okay, I missed all that.
So. I have a motion for approval.
Go for it.
All right. Findings of fact. One, Ernest and Geraldine Fusco are requesting a resource protection permit to alter 100 square feet of RP2 wetland for a path slash boardwalk located at 11 Angel Point Road, which requires review under section 19-8-3 resource protection regulations. Two, the proposed path boardwalk will not material obstruct the flow of surface or subsurface waters across or from the alteration area. Three, the proposed path boardwalk will not impound surface waters or reduce the absorptive capacity of the alteration area so as to cause or increase the flooding of adjacent properties. Four, the proposed path boardwalk will not increase the flow of surface waters across or the discharge of waters, surface waters from the alteration area so as to threaten injury to the alteration area or to upstream and or downstream lands by flooding, draining, erosion, sedimentation, or otherwise. Five, the proposed path boardwalk will not result in significant damage to spawning ground or habitat for aquatic life, birds, or other wildlife. Six, the proposed path boardwalk will not pose problems related to the support of structures. Seven, the proposed path boardwalk will not be detrimental to aquifer recharge or the quantity or quality of groundwater. Eight, the proposed path boardwalk will not disturb coastal dunes or contiguous back dune areas. Nine, the proposed path boardwalk will not maintain or improve ecological and aesthetic values. 10, the proposed path boardwalk will not damage any vegetated buffer areas between the wetland and adjacent land uses. 11, the proposed path boardwalk will not cause erosion. 12, the proposed path boardwalk will not increase discharge or wastewater. And 13, the proposed path boardwalk is not located in a resource protection floodplain district. And 14, the application substantially complies with section 9-8-3 resource protection regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Ernest and Geraldine Fusco for a resource protection permit to alter 100 square feet of RP2 wetland for a path slash boardwalk located at 11 Angel Point Road be approved.
Second.
Just a quick comment.
You got to mention number nine.
Number nine,
okay.
Did you say will?
Why don't you just put
I thought I said will not because I have it underlined on my paper, but if I did, I would move
would
to
would you take a friendly?
I would love a friendly amendment.
Okay.
So it would be a proposed path boardwalk will not maintain or improve ecological.
Will maintain.
Oh, will. Sorry. That's what.
Will maintain.
You're leading me in the right direction, but I wasn't listening. The proposed path boardwalk will maintain or improve ecological and aesthetic values.
So we have a friendly amendment request. The
second.
Okay. All right. Any further discussion?
Just Peter? One question. It was mentioned, I think, that the path or the easement would only be used by the owners of the parcel that abuts you to the north. Does the board have any interest in limiting that? The permit to the owners of the residential property or something of this nature. I don't know if it could ever be subdivided or.
Would it be trespassing? Somebody just
use the land as loot? Well, no. Could they develop and turn it into three lots and have three families with, you know.
No.
It doesn't strike me.
They stated in their presentation that neither lot that we're talking about is divisible.
And also, I believe we received a letter from the owner of that property that indicated as much, so I'm not concerned about
that. Just rely on the facts submitted and go ahead with that condition.
Neither property is divisible. Okay.
And also, Maureen, is that letter part of the record that we received from the owner of that property?
I believe it is.
Okay.
Any other concerns, comments, questions? All those in favor? Opposed? Boy, we're in agreement tonight. Unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm agreeing with Henry all night long. It's crazy, crazy, crazy. Okay.
Who seconded that?
Was it Henry?
I think Henry.
Okay, thank you.
All right. I've lost my agenda. The next item on our agenda is the accessory structures amendments. Town Council has referred to the Planning Board review of an amendment that restricts overnight accommodations in accessory structures and how the impacts, how it, that impacts seasonal agricultural worker housing and more generally overnight accommodations on farms. The Planning Board is not recommending additional zoning ordinance amendments and will hold a public hearing prior to making this recommendation to the Town Council. We have before us a letter that we received and reviewed at our workshop that outlines that to the Town Council and sends it back to the Council with recommending no changes. Okay, so I'm supposed to have a public hearing on this. Is there anyone here who would like to speak to this? All right, seeing no one, public hearing is closed. As far as the board goes, any comments? Go ahead, Victoria.
I'll say that we had a very good meeting with a representative from the Cape Farm Alliance. Hopefully, we did answer all questions. And at the end of that meeting, I think we came to an understanding that the reason we don't need any change to the ordinance is because everything that may have been of a concern, there came to be a realization that, oh, there are no impediments truly from this that would hurt any of our plans. It was, like I said, a very good discussion, and that's why we're actually making the recommendation not to do anything.
Any other comments? Do we have a motion? Go ahead, Joe.
Bottom of the second page.
Motion, excuse me, motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the information reviewed and the facts presented, the Planning Board does not recommend amendments to the zoning ordinance related to the use of accessory structures for overnight accommodations.
Second for Henry. All right, any further comment? All those in favor? Oh, wow, we're on a roll. And all those opposed? 7-0. All right, public comment on items not on the agenda. Is there anyone who wishes to comment on items not on the agenda? You're all set? Okay.
Make a moot.
All right.
Can I just make one comment to just echo what Peter said at the beginning of the meeting with regards to Elaine? I'm sure she's watching at home at this late hour.
Oh, I'm sure
right
she
now,
is.
But,
sure
she is. Just also get on the record. I did appreciate what Peter said about that, and we do appreciate all of Elaine's hard work, and I think everybody can say that.
Yes.
But just want to throw that out there to all the public that's still here.
So we should all wait.
I'm sure she's asleep. All right. Do I have a motion?
Yes. Move to adjourn.
All right. I have a motion to adjourn. Do I have a second? Okay. Joe seconds. Any discussion? Anyone want to debate that? All right. All those in favor? Okay. Opposed? 7-0.
Too bad.